Welcome, everyone, to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speak. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And also make sure that you like the video on your way in. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel and click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single solitary chapter of these mind-numbing books, y'all. Listen, these books have you tied up in a slip knot. But anyway, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. Welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers, and those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way y'all love on me. Child, listen, I was cracking up laughing when I came onto the mic because I had just told my son. I said, you know, I would love to see Mercedes giving the Mercedes experience over there at the Pink to my intro music. God damn, that would be nice. Lord have mercy. Listen, I have a tremendous amount of respect for women that can get on a pole and work that motherfucker like it's about to start spitting out money, child. Oh, Lord have mercy. Anyway, so how y'all doing today? Let me see who's here with me, child. I know a whole lot of folks is over there watching the mess go down, and I don't blame them because some of y'all just like mess, child. You just feel like your life ain't complete unless you're indulging in a little bit of mess. But ain't nobody got time for that, y'all. Only mess I like is on a TV show, in a movie, or in these raggedy-ass books we be reading over here. All right, so hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire, and nerve-wracking-ass little sister. Hey, girl, hey, thank you so much for being here, darling. I love you, and I appreciate you. Welcome. All right, honestly, Kay was first through the door, child. She had claimed her a good seat back there on the good couch. Grand Rising, darling, welcome, and thank you so much for being here. Next in the building, we got Nordic. Grand Rising, darling, welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. I saw you, Kim Cash, getting your swerve on, child, coming through the door. Hey, girl, hey. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Aw, shit. Choco Chip is in the building, and she done came in with a whole bushel basket of good vibes. It's about to be a good live stream. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome. All right. I think I got everybody, child, because, and you know these folks, child. She's that's us working on the wall. Wait, did y'all see that little boy that I had dancing on my stories on Instagram? I think I had that up there yesterday. I don't think I put it back up there today. But child, listen, that little boy was getting his boogie on, and I said, me, on my way to the, with my intro drop at the Speakeasy. Child, listen, that little boy was getting it. Do you hear me? He had his little shirt off and had his little hands behind his head, and he was getting his boogie on. You hear me? All right, so listen, y'all. I'm going to get y'all a couple tree hours up here, and then I'll take a quick little break and get my chicken out the brine, child. And then I will, I'll come back, because I told y'all we're going to finish this shit up this week. I know you lying. I need ethic out of my system. Because he's in my system. Yes. And so I need him out. Okay. All right, so let me get my time stamp, and then we can get started. There we go. Chapter 4. You ready, bro? Issa asked. Messiah looked around the master bedroom of his home, and he tightened his face to stop the emotion from becoming evident. He could still hear Morgan's laughter bouncing off the walls in the room. He could still see her lying beneath him at night, refusing to utilize her side of the bed because Mo was clingy. And she didn't care that she made him hot as fuck at night. He tossed the last stack of cash from his safe in his Louis duffel and then zipped it. He wasn't taking anything but clothes and cash. Everything else could stay. Yeah, I'm ready, he confirmed. Yo, bro, you should go talk to her, Issa said. Shit, a nigga need you to holler at her. And I was this close to knocking Ali down. Now you got a nigga dodging her calls. Messiah sniggered. Snigger, not snigger. Is that a nigger snicker? So it's called a snigger. Oh my God. I don't even know where the fuck I got that word. Sniggered. Hoshi-toshi, grasshopper. Grand Rising Learning. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, girl. Hey. Listen, I don't even know where the hell I got that from, Sniggered. Anyway, he said, I was this close to knocking Allie down. Now you got a nigga dodging her calls. Messiah snickered. Right, he didn't snigger. Anyway, you wasn't hitting shit, nigga. Aria wasn't fucking with your ass, Messiah said, giving up a half smile at how hard his mans was chasing it. Nigga, I would have been knee deep in that shit by summer, my G. The way she popped that shit on stage, bruh, Issa groaned. Messiah shook his head, but he could relate. He headed for the door. Meek was in the living room waiting. Everything G, bro? You ready? Meek asked. You know we can just pop ethic and stay right here in town, Issa proposed. We rockin' with whatever you decide. Messiah had considered all the possibilities, but killing ethic would erase any chance he had to ever even speak to Morgan again. Odds were already slim, but taking that step would annihilate them. He wasn't ready to live a life that didn't have the possibility of her in it. He told himself he would come back one day when things were calmer. She had time to decompress. If he made it that long, killing ethic was not only dangerous, but damaging. If Messiah was honest with himself, he would admit that he had love for ethic. He was his OG. He had taught him too much to follow through with such a treacherous plan. Messiah would walk away with his soul clean on this one. He would take the L and love Mo from afar because no one else was getting close to his heart. Nah, all this shit is dead. This town is dead. Let's shake, he said. And what about little homie? What we doing with him? Issa asked, nodding to the sleeping toddler that rested on the couch. Blue's gonna take care of him for me, Messiah said. Make sure he gets to a good family and shit. Somebody who won't fuck him up. His heart was the heaviest it had ever been as he walked out the door. It had been too long since he'd last seen her. Morgan was like air. She filled up his lungs every time he laid eyes on her. Without her, he was on E. He could barely breathe. It hurt so fucking bad. If he could have one more day with her versus 100 years without her, he'd choose those glorious 24 hours and die happy. She had called so many times he had to block her just to resist answering for her. He felt like a snake. Messiah had seen his share of grimy days and he knew he was a menace to most, but to her, he had been good. Living with her, disappointment was crushing him. The voice messages she had left him didn't even sound like her, the begging torn in half. Never ever was it okay to live in a world where Morgan Atkins had to plead for love. Sadness had transformed her. It was suffocating him, but his poker face was strong. He stepped out onto the porch and paused when he saw Blue pull up in front of his house. Load up. I'll be there, Messiah called out to the crew. So you're leaving? Blue asked as she came up to him, standing directly in front of him, arms crossed, face bent in disbelief and anger. But the underlying emotion, the one that caused her eyes to glisten, was sadness. Messiah meant everything to her. She loved him, and watching him was an inevitable torture. I gotta shake. It's hot, he said, as he swung his hands in front of his body, one hand catching the other balled fist as he looked down the block. His eyes stung and he sniffed it away. If he had ever been capable of loving someone before Morgan, it would have been Blue. From the very first time he'd laid eyes on her, he'd known she was a special girl. The friendship they had built over the years was valuable to him. It meant something, and he didn't realize it until this very moment when he was forced to let it go. Damn, that probably did have to hurt y'all to walk away from his best friend, best female friend, because he'd taken his boys with him, so. And I think she was probably more of a little sister to him than Wosie was. Messiah, she whispered sympathetically, she loves you. I love you, boy. Savior loves you. You have people here. You can't just run from this. Shit gets hard. You talk it out. You work through it. You don't run off. That girl is ruined. You chewed her up at my house. Don't do this. You can have an entire life here. We both know that's a lie, B, Messiah said. A nigga lucky to have what I had with her. The time I had, I wasn't old. When you live foul, you fucking die foul. I never deserved her in the first fucking place. He had to frown, folding his emotion to stop himself from crying. He felt it, the sobs, the urge to fall into Blue's arms and pour his pain all over her. He had been plugging that hole his entire life. She'll be by your side when it gets bad, because you know it's gonna get bad, Messiah. I was gonna put a bullet in his head, Blue. Ethic ain't forgetting that shit. So either I murk that nigga and she hate me forever, or I leave and I miss her forever, Messiah said. Or he kills me, and none of the above is an option. Forever ain't that long. I'ma be good. He nodded like he was trying to convince himself. You're breaking my heart, Messiah, she whispered. Blue felt a tear fall down her cheek. She swiped it away. Yeah, apparently that's all the fuck I'm good for, he said. The somberness of his tone told her he was ashamed of that. He didn't care about who he decimated in the past. His actions were his actions, and he never apologized for them. But this time, he was filled with remorse, overwhelmed with a regret so strong that a tear slipped down the bridge of his nose. I'm fucked up. Never let anybody bend my name when it come to her, B. Never let niggas say I did what I did because I hated her. I never hated her. I love her. Don't let them run the stories back no different. I love her the only way I know how, B, he said, lip quivering. He had no control over his emotions. The vulnerability was painful to a man who was used to feeling nothing. My Messiah, Blue whispered. She reached up to touch his face. You're worth so much and don't even know it. The kid is in there. Make sure whoever gets him takes care of him, B. Make sure he's safe. Make sure nobody's doing no shit to him, abusing him. Give him a chance, Messiah said. His voice was so weak, weaker than she'd ever heard him. He hoped Wozie's son had a better chance than he had ever been given. And the house? What am I supposed to do with it? She asked. Messiah looked back up at it. Give it to Mo. She won't want it anytime soon. She'll hate me for a while, but one day, when she hate a nigga a little less, give it to her. Her name is already on the deed. Messiah, this isn't right, she whispered. I don't know how Ethic moving with it, so steer clear. He was ignoring her pleas to stay, diverting the conversation. Last thing I want is for you to pay for being affiliated with me, Messiah said. Amon has me covered. You don't have to worry about me, she said. Blue's lip quivered. What if we don't get to see you again before... Messiah reached down and wrapped his arms around Blue, kissing her cheek. One peck, then burying his face in the groove of her neck, then another peck before burying himself there again. She felt one sob before he holstered his feelings. She broke down in his arms. Stop, Shorty Doo-Wop. I'll see you one day. She nodded, quickly regaining her composure. Now, nah, boy, there's only one Shorty Doo-Wop now, and it ain't me, she said with a smile. I want to see you once a month, a lunch date. Every single month, Messiah, you open my Christmas gift and you go there once a month. I'll meet you there. You've been my best friend since Noah. She stopped speaking because it was so hard to reminisce about old times without breaking down, about the man she had loved and lost in the blink of an eye. I need to know that no matter how far you go, she paused again, because it was so damn hard to tell her friend goodbye. She knew it might be goodbye for good and it was tearing her up inside. I need a day to look forward to seeing you. Just open the gift and go there. Meet me there, okay? Messiah instantly thought of Morgan, wishing he could somehow have the same arrangement with her, wishing this goodbye was being had with another, or better yet, that it didn't have to occur at all. He nodded. You can bet on that, he promised. Tell Savior to be good. You be good too, Blue. Stay clean. Besides Morgan, Blue was the only other person he was worried about leaving. She had a dark history with addiction, and he didn't want her falling off. Always, she said, with a nod and a tear-filled gaze. She taught you how to love, Messiah. At least call her. He nodded. I will. They both knew he was lying, and as he got in the car, his entire chest felt split open. Blue threw up a hand as he watched her grow smaller and smaller in the side passenger mirror. He tossed a hand out the window to bid her farewell as he and the crew rode through Flint. For the last time. Ah, and there's a break in the chapter. Man, I was hoping Ethic's ass would get there before old boy pulled off so he could just tell him, hey, man, she having your baby. The feeling can't be beat, but you gotta decide where the baby's gonna sleep. Go to the baby's room. Do y'all remember them weird ass commercials for the baby room? I don't even know if, is that store even still open? I don't know why that shit popped in my damn head, but whatever, child. I don't know if it's still open or not. All right. Let me, I need to adjust the text in this book, the size of the letters. Y'all hold on. It's okay, that could be. It don't move slowly. I'm sorry. I told y'all I'm a whole weirdo over here. Y'all be thinking I'm playing. But I don't be playing, child. All right, I don't know. That seems a little small, child. Deal with the fact that it's big. That's what I told him. Anyway, right, here we go. Ethic pulled up to Messiah's home, and as soon as he climbed from his Tesla, he knew Messiah was gone. The curtains were open. That was indication number one that Messiah had blown town. He didn't care who saw inside. Ethic gritted his teeth and gripped his steering wheel in frustration because he knew if Messiah went underground, he would never find him. Ethic had taught Messiah, mentored him, gained him up from a young age. Messiah would move with precision now that he thought Ethic was a threat. Ethic wouldn't find Messiah until he wanted to be found, but he wanted a timeline, a 40-week timeline to be exact. Morgan needed him, and Ethic had a feeling that Messiah would miss the birth of his child. Burden filled him because he didn't want that type of heartbreak for Morgan. He had never wanted her to feel anything but love. If Messiah was going to take the job from Ethic, he needed to do it better. Familial ties and treachery lied between them. The bloodlines were now crossed. Morgan would bring Messiah's seed into the world. Izon's nephew. What a sticky web love had weaved. Ethic didn't have a choice but to make it right, but it was too late. The one fucking time this motherfucker want to follow directions. He grumbled. Ethic pulled away from the block, knowing in his heart that he would have to equip Morgan with the strength she needed to raise her child without Messiah. Ah. There's another break in the chapter. That's why I stopped. I'm wondering if he can go to old girl. What's her name? Y'all know what I'm talking about. To Blue and ask her to help. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know. I'm wondering if she would help him, to get in touch if Blue would call Messiah. I'm sure she can. I don't know. I just fucking hate this shit. Like, this don't make no damn sense. But I'm sure she, old girl know how to get in touch with his punk ass. I be getting mad, yo. Because this is some bullshit. It don't even have to be this way. Because I don't know. Anyway, just fuck it. All right. Let me get back to it, child. Yes, Blue. Oh, she don't know what. Oh yeah, she do. She would answer. Blue would answer. excuse me. Answer Morgan's calls, and of course Messiah will always answer Blue's call because she got his the. I'm about to say she got his baby. She has his nephew. So yeah, that's why I was thinking maybe she would be the person, but I don't know. Anyway. All right, here we go. Please don't make me do this. Please, Ethic, please, Morgan cried. She bounced as she begged him, stomping one foot desperately, hoping her tears were enough to get him to take her home. He always gave her the desires of her heart when she threw a fit. He hated to see her cry, and he was struggling with leaving her inside the four walls of this hospital. It's not up to me, Mo, he whispered. It is up to you, she shouted. Ethic, please, I just want to go home. Don't leave me here. Messiah already left. You can't leave me too. She was hysterical. The terror that glistened in her tears tore the moxie right out of Ethic's spine. His stomach weakened, and he pulled a distraught Morgan into his arms. I'm never leaving you, Mo. Just got to get better, baby girl. You feel my heart beating? He asked. She nodded. As long as it's beating, you got me, he said. Then just take me home, she said, wrapping her arms around his neck. She locked her hands together like a stubborn toddler who didn't want to be pulled away from her father. Two nurses approached the pair to break up the scene. The dependency Morgan possessed when it came to ethics was showing. He was hers, her protector and the love of her young life. She could depend on him. She always had. She needed him to just save her. She didn't want anyone to fix her but him, because he was the only one who understood why she was the way she was. Soulmates of a different form. Epic was the most important person in her life. Even Messiah didn't measure up when it came to prioritizing her love. You have to let go, one of them said. She pulled Morgan, and Epic wrapped a protective hand around Morgan's back, stiff-arming the hospital staff with his free hand. Don't touch her. The order came out with such force that it ricocheted through the room like a gunshot. Morgan clenched her eyes. Ethic, no, no. Don't let them take me, she cried. I don't know about this, he said, wavering. I can hire the best therapist to come to the house. Mr. Okafor, she'll have to complete a 72-hour suicide hold. We recommend you commit her longer, but it's the law that we have to keep her for 72 hours after regaining consciousness. That's true. That's absolutely true. It don't matter how long you stay out. Once you regain consciousness, they have to complete that 72-hour hold because, I mean, you're there because you attempted to end your life, ma'am. Like, they're not playing like that. I know, right? I'm trying to use my logic, and I don't even know how this is going to work, child. I just want that man to be there to raise his baby, but I don't know. All right, let me keep reading. A male nurse approached this time, and Ethic slapped his hand down forcefully. Don't fucking touch her. Who the fuck are you? You put your hands on her again, and I'll put you in a box. Ethic pointed a finger at the man, sneering, as his temple throbbed and his heart ached. This was the hardest thing he'd ever had to do, and Morgan's fear, her absolute terror, was putting him in a position of defense. He felt inclined to protect her. Alani stood off to the side, heart breaking, one hand placed over her mouth in disbelief. She now knew what she was up against with Morgan Atkins. This was no normal connection between father and child. This was a love affair with limits. Ethic and Morgan had created the purest form of love and wrapped rules around it that kept it appropriate, but she could see that he loved her differently than his other children. He loved her more than his other children. It wasn't romantic, but it wasn't platonic either. It was obsessive, like Morgan didn't want to share Ethic with anyone ever. Ethic had unknowingly encouraged the bond over the years. She had lost everyone in her life, so she overindulged in loving Ethic, and he poured everything into her to make up for it. They had never healed from the trauma that connected them. Instead, they bound their hearts together and let them bleed and scab over, leaving behind a gruesome scar. It was devastating to bear witness to this moment. Alani felt like she shouldn't be there, like she was a fly on the wall taking part in an interaction that she had no business being a part of. For the first time since meeting Ethic, she felt like she didn't belong. Ethic, they just want to help, Alani said softly. She wants me in here. She just wants me out the way. Ethic, no! Morgan's pleas ripped through him. He placed a hand on the back of her head. Alani lowered her head and closed her eyes. The accusation stung and silenced her instantly. She didn't want that. She would never want that. But she knew it wasn't a time to discuss her wants and needs. Nobody wants you out the way, baby girl. We just need you to be okay. I need you to talk to somebody, he whispered. He kissed the side of her head. This baby needs you. I need you. Easy and Bella need you. Nobody's leaving you. Nobody's replacing you. We all want you home, Mo. Let's just try the 3 days. If you want to come home after 3 days, then we're out of here. They can't keep you after that. And if they try, I'll tear every wall down in this motherfucker to bring you home. That's my word. But I really need you to try, Mo. I almost lost my favorite girl. I got to make sure you're getting the help you need. Make sure you're strong up here, he said, tapping her temple as their foreheads met. I'm scared. This feels like I'm being punished, like they're locking me up. Her lip trembled and spread wide in dismay. You know, I would never let that happen, Mo, he said. You're not in trouble. No one's upset with you, baby girl. I love you. You're mine. You think I'm going to let somebody take you from me? He asked. She drew in a shaky breath as she calmed slightly. He would never. She believed that much. "You can do this, Morgan," he said. She held both her, oh, sorry, he held both her hands, and she wrapped her fingers around his so tightly that it hurt. He brought her bald fists up to his lips and kissed them. "3 days?" she asked. "Just 3 days," he answered. "Okay," she gave in. Child, listen, this is weird because, like, I get what, I get what Alani is feeling. Like, for the first time, I understand what the fuck she's feeling. Like, this is something different. Ethic is trying to do for Morgan what he couldn't do for Raven, which is protect her. I mean, because remember, that was his fucking, you know, that was his whole get down with her in the first place. So, but the bad part about it is that Alani doesn't understand because he hasn't told her the whole story about he and Raven. And so because of that, she's witnessing something. Like, it is. It's thoroughly platonic. Like, he don't want to fuck Morgan. She's a kid. But the whole idea is that from the outside, looking in without knowing the backstory, you could look at that and think that that's what it is. But that's not what it is. Like, she's just, in his mind, his oldest daughter. At least that's what I'm reading thus far. It's not odd. It's that he, remember, first of all, she was special needs because she was deaf, right? That's first. And then she was the one child that belonged to her father that he could actually save because he was responsible for the other girl's death. So, like, when you look at it from that perspective, I don't think that he is, like, he don't have those kind of feelings. At least I don't read that so far. Now, he ain't revealed shit either. And the way he treats her is just like a father would treat a daughter. But he ain't let us, you know, into the most intimate parts of his brain to know what he thinks when he sees her. But so far, he looks at her like a daughter. So I don't know. I don't know. But I guess, you know, see, here's the thing. And this is the absolute truth. Without even, from a real world perspective, women who have experienced any sort of trauma from an older person would look at this and see, like, oh my God, it's something weird about this. It's something odd about this. That's crazy. But it's like, if you a hammer, you see nails everywhere, right? That's all you see is nails. So if you're traumatized, all you see is like, oh, that could be something like this. That could be like something like what happened to me. That could be something like what happened to this girl I knew. That could be something like what happened to my cousin Talisha, right? Because that's the way your mind begins to think and process things once you learn or gain the understanding that men, for the most part, are trash and they do inappropriate things to children. It's been all through the book. It's been all through the books. That's it. So, of course, that's what you see. But what I see is a man that feels guilty that he's the reason why Raven is dead, right? Obviously, he couldn't save her parents. So he was left with Morgan to take care of and easy. And, of course, Morgan's not his biological daughter, but he wanted to make her feel like she still had the structure and the protection and the love of a father, right? So he loves her and treats her like a father would a daughter. I mean, is that making sense to y'all, or are y'all only seeing something inappropriate? Because I personally don't see anything inappropriate here other than him trying to say to her, even though you're not my daughter, I still love you like you're my daughter, and I'm gonna protect you. Like, he feels not only obligated to protect her and take care of her, he really absolutely does love her. He's responsible for raising her. So, like, I don't know if that makes sense. And I hope that this book doesn't reveal that there's anything appropriate, right? I mean, but what makes you think that there aren't boundaries already, Nordic? It seems to me that there are boundaries. There are. There absolutely are. Like, he ain't tried to push up on her at all. The boundaries are there. We have not heard him say anything sexual about Morgan at all. I just don't see that. It seems to me like he is very much just a father taking care of a child. I don't see anything appropriate. You know, he ain't said nothing like the way she's shaking her titties or the way her ass wobbled. I notice it. And if I notice it other than, no, I don't think that, like, he ain't said nothing like that. You understand what I'm saying? He's basically just trying to protect her. You know, I don't think, you know, I just feel like he's just a dad. I really do. Yeah, no one said it. No, but what other boundary would be inappropriate, you know? Okay, well, you know, you got to send me an email, child, or something, because I don't know, you know, I don't feel like there aren't boundaries. I think that he's just like any other dad, and the boundaries are there. I just don't think that it's, you know, I think people make more out of it than they need to, because I don't know. Maybe because I'm a daddy's girl and I know how, you know, some dads love their children inappropriately, child. Okay. And then some dads have clear-cut boundaries and they still shower their daughters with love and affection and protection and all of that. And it's not odd or weird. And it only ever looks odd or weird to people who haven't had that. If you haven't had that, then it looks odd. It looks weird. It looks like it's too much, but it's not. And it's also in the protection of a nigga that knows that he done ran through a bunch of bitches and he know the shit that niggas do to bitches, and he's trying to protect his daughter from that. You understand what I'm saying? Like, when, okay, put it like this. I have a friend back home in Chicago. Dog-ass nigga, man. Dog-ass dick when I was. Nigga banged many holes, you hear me? Like, ran through them just like a bowling ball through bowling ball pins. Like, seriously, he just ran them down. And then he fucked around and got married and had a daughter. And I just, you know, when I heard his wife had a girl, I said, boy, you know karmic retribution is a motherfucker, don't you? For whatever reason, that shit flipped the switch in his head. And when I tell you, he don't give his daughter 5 minutes to breathe, okay? 5 minutes to breathe. He was hawking. He was like a hawk. Don't talk to boys. Don't look at boys. Don't think about boys. I know the shit he's pointing. I'm like, nigga. I'm like, you thinking that these young boys are thinking the same way you used to think? You were a young boy, you can't protect her from everybody. And you can't protect her from everything, sir. Oh boy, when them chickens come home to roost, they just be up there like, ah, 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 ah. Right. And you can't be sitting up there talking about, it stops here. No, it doesn't. No, sorry. And eventually, they will get right on up and through there, boo. They sure do. Mm-hmm. All right. Uh-huh. Because the only thing that played in his mind was the shit he did, the thoughts that he had. And I think that that is a little bit of what Ethic is doing, too, because he knows the shit that he did. He already said it. He's left a bunch of broken hearts in his wake. Mm-hmm. Right. He didn't make any promises, but women inevitably set themselves up to be hurt because of how we're made. Right. You know, we see some strong, brooding guy with issues and we just make ourselves available. Right. Even when they tell us, hey, I ain't looking for nothing serious. You know, this is a fucking duck. Right. I'm going to fuck you and then I'm going to duck out on you. And we all sit back thinking that our coochies are the coup de grace of coochies. And actually, coochie's coochie. You know, it's all about the woman attached to it. It's not coochie. It's the woman attached to it. The coochie's the cherry on top, honey. And it's the woman that doesn't try that usually gets the nigga. These women out here trying too hard get a nigga, but they don't get the nigga. Not the one that they really want. not the one that's going to love them like they need to be loved. And then it seems like the one that ain't trying at all get the nigga and then act like, well, what I got to do to keep them? Just be. But that's all unhealed trauma. So to my point, I think Ethic is aware of all the shit that he's done, and he is trying to protect Morgan from that. And I think he going to be the same fucking way with Bella. Right? Because remember, he couldn't protect her fucking mama either, because her mama went back to another dude. Right. So now, that's just it. So I don't think there's anything inappropriate, and I think the boundaries are clearly defined. Morgan is just possessive. Yeah. And territorial as fuck. Mm-hmm. Because like she said, at first, it was her and Ethic both grieving the loss of Raven. And then Alani showed up and she kind of, you know, wiped the bird shit off the windshield for Ethic, right? And Messiah was supposed to have done the same for her, and he did. But now that Messiah's gone, Ethic is no longer leaning on her, and she can no longer lean on him like that. So now she got to figure out something else. That's inappropriate territorial behavior on her part, not on his. He's just being a reassuring dad. So that's it. All right, so let me get back to this. A black woman with silver hair and a white doctor's coat stood next to Morgan, placing one gentle hand on her shoulder. My name is Dr. Gates. I'm the head of psychiatry here. I'll personally be handling Morgan's evaluation and hopefully her treatment plan if you decide to pursue it after the 3-day hold. I promise you, I will take the utmost care of her. This is the hard part, admitting that a loved one needs help. That prayer can't fix it. Morgan didn't cut a wrist for attention. She created a death chamber inside your home. She's a danger to herself, and I know leaving her feels like torture. But taking her would show that you don't care, Mr. Okafor. It would be the biggest form of neglect because your love can't fix the depression rotting in her mind. Let me help her, the woman said. Ethic pulled Morgan to his chest and gritted his teeth, locking his jaw as he looked the doctor in the eyes. I need you to understand what's at stake with her, Ethic said. I understand. She's your child. She's my soul, he stated. One person mishandled her in here, and Ezra, Alani interrupted. She was his owner. She stopped his bark. She wouldn't even allow him to get his bite off. Morgan squeezed his waist tighter. Ethic looked at Alani and then to the doctor. Take care of her, he said, clearing his throat. He grabbed Morgan's arms and had to physically pry her from his waist. Her tears were endless. I'll be here every day, he said. She won't be allowed visitors during evaluation, the doctor said. Ethic swiped a hand down his face. 3 days, Mo. She nodded, and he kissed the top of her head before walking out of the room. Alani hesitated, wishing she could say something to Morgan, but she opted for silence before following. Ethic stood directly outside the door, palms to the wall, doubled over in agony. Pause. I feel like Alani should have gone to Morgan and just hugged her and said, listen, I promise you it's going to be okay. Like, because Morgan got a love-hate relationship with Alani that's weird. Like, she wants the mothering, but she understands what she thinks in her mind, that Alani's presence somehow diminishes Ethic's love for her. Like, Alani takes up room in his heart, and it squeezes her out. But she doesn't understand that love don't work like that. And because she lost her dad, when she was fucking, what, 6 or 7 years old? She was a kid when she lost him. She don't get it, right? And then after that, her mom. And then after that, her sister. So she's had a lot of loss. And this man has been the one constant in her life. So now she like, oh, here come this bitch trying to take him away from me. It's childish. But most people's emotions come from a childish place anyway. An unhealed child on top of that. So yeah. This was causing him physical pain. His stomach was in knots of torture because more than anything, he wanted to carry Morgan out of this hospital. He was like a ticking time bomb, and Alani didn't know what would set him off. Her hand shook as she placed it on his back, easing closer to him. He felt her shaking, and he stood upright, peering at her. He knew she was afraid, and he pulled her into him. Life is never easy with me, Lenika. I'm sorry it's so hard. I'm sorry I can't give you a simple. You deserve simple. I just want you, she whispered. We've been through the worst. We can get through this. You can't ask for miracles and then not want to put in the work to make sure they last. We prayed that she'd wake up. She did. God blessed her. I felt her heart die beneath my hands when I was giving her CPR. She's not supposed to be here, but she's here. Doing the work to make sure she never hurts herself again is not optional. She doesn't want to. You don't want to, but she has to. It's not an option. You're her parent. That comes with tough decisions. You have a phenomenal heart, and you want to see them happy. But being a parent is more about... It's about more than just giving them everything and saying yes to everything. You have to make the hard decisions that may not feel so good right now, but will build her up in the long run. She needs this. You're not hurting her by keeping her here. You're helping her. You're doing the right thing, Ethic. He pressed his forehead to hers, eyes closed. I don't even know why you fuck with me, he admitted. Because my love for you has no limits, she whispered. Their normal dynamic had always been him wrapping her, securing her in his hold. This time, she placed hands to his chest, and ran them north and then around his neck, securing him in the safety of her. Their embrace created alternate universes where nothing could penetrate, nothing could harm them, as long as they were trapped there. A hug, so simple, their connection, so complicated. E and A. So fucking tragic, they were beautiful. Like a sad poem that was read so many times it became a masterpiece. Ethic and Alani's love was art. Witnesses may grow confused. They may wonder how it was considered great. Looking at them inside a frame required one to squint really hard, turn their head to the side just to attempt to understand such a piece. The artist was the greatest of them all. God. God held a paintbrush, and he had perfected his stroke on the two of them. She pulled back and took his hand, lacing their fingers as they headed for the exit. They both knew that they were leaving behind an intricate piece of their puzzle because the picture of their family could not be complete without Morgan Atkins. That's the end of that chapter. Oh, child, listen, this is some bullshit, child. I'm sorry, y'all, that y'all can, hear that damn washing machine spinning. I'm about ready to go in there and stop it. Because it's spinning for fucking days. All right, so let me scroll back and see what y'all saying. Yeah, I get it, child. She gonna make it hard for me to get it. Okay, so you were saying not Ethic, but Morgan. Okay, all right, I got you. I got you. Oh, child. I know that's the bad part. Oh, you can't hear it? Yay. All right. Well, you'll hear it when it stops, child. My son decided to wash right before I go live, child. While I'm sitting here. Right off the doggone laundry room. Let me see. And I wish it was a door there. Cause like you can, like I can see straight into it and then, you know, straight out the window to the back of the house. But anyway. All right, let me get this next time stamp, child. I'm glad y'all came here because that boy is in there spinning like crazy, child. What the hell? How long? All right, good. All right, call the microphone good. Chapter 5, Shoelaces, the intake nurse said. What? Morgan frowned. Morgan was relieved that her voice had returned, but she wished it hadn't because now she was expected to speak. She was required to communicate. She didn't want to talk about it. If it wasn't Ethic or Messiah, she didn't want to say one word. They were the only two people in the world who understood her, not these doctors with their fake sympathy and their notepads. She would never trust them, could never trust them to interpret the woe in her heart. What she felt was like a foreign language. Not many people understood the way she loved. Her love was like a tattoo, permanent, almost impossible to remove. To even attempt it was painful. One had to think twice before committing to it in the first place. She couldn't talk to these doctors. They didn't know her pain. They didn't even speak her love language. They could never understand. We need your laces. It's a safety concern. You can hurt yourself with them. Morgan wanted to protest, but she didn't. Humiliation stained her as she lifted one foot and removed the laces, and then did the same with the opposite foot. Your father dropped off some personal items. I need to go through it and remove all the items on our prohibited list, okay? Now, I can hear that. I know y'all heard the doggone thing. The bell. One second, y'all. One second. Kay said, well, it was a nice tune. They give you a whole list to choose from. That one was the cute one. All right. Morgan nodded. Surviving suicide might have been worse than dying. Now she had to face people. Now she had to stare into judgmental eyes. And what she didn't realize is nobody at the hospital was judging her. Well, not anybody on her care team anyway. They completely understand, but you know how when you're in your own head, all you can think about is people must be thinking the worst of you. That's all you can think, is that they must be thinking the absolute worst, but they're not, child. They just want to help you get your shit straight so you can go on about your fucking life, because nobody wants to see somebody, you know, going back and forth, you know, from 5150 after 5150 and dealing with depression and thoughts of suicide, child. That part. All right. She had to stare into judgmental eyes. She knew they thought she was crazy. Perhaps she was. Perhaps the desperation she felt to escape this anguish was too great, immeasurable. The pain was overwhelming, and Morgan just wanted it to ease some. It was the opposite of love. Whatever that was, couldn't be hate because Mo didn't hate Messiah. She kept waiting for him to realize she needed him, kept anticipating his rescue because he had to feel that she was in trouble. Why couldn't she feel him? Why hadn't he come? His words kept ringing in her ears over and over. I don't give a fuck anymore. A permanent echo because he had left her chest vacant. He had snatched her heart right out of it, and now his words just bounced off the chambers, forcing her to hear it again and again. He had sealed her fate in that moment. She cared too much and he cared too little. The unbalance was killing her. It was like the last year of her life had been a dream. Like she had made it up in her head. It couldn't have been real because Messiah would never have been able to stand this space between them if it was. He would feel the anxiety she felt just from the separation alone. She spun the hospital bracelet that decorated her wrist. I need my hairpins. Oh, no, I need any hairpins you have in your hair, the nurse said. What the hell am I saying? It's because I'm, my eyes, you know how when you're reading, your eyes are already a line ahead of it? That part. Her tone froze Morgan. She was cold, sterile even. My hairpins? It's all that's keeping my hair in place. Why do I have to take them out? Morgan asked. They're sharp. You can't have them. She lifted shaky hands and removed all her bobby pins, placing them in the biohazard bag. The nurse rifled through her things, removing her Fenty blush because the mirror could be broken and used to slit her wrists. She removed her rat tail comb because of the pointed end. Morgan's Louis Vuitton planner was opened and shook out. What are you doing? She asked. I don't think you understand the magnitude of what you've done. You are not allowed to keep anything that you can potentially use to hurt yourself or others, the woman snapped. The woman took the pen Morgan used to write with and tossed it in the bag. Even her cell phone was confiscated. The Hermes belt that Ethic had packed was rolled up and put inside the plastic bag. Morgan shivered and pulled the blanket over her shoulders like a cape. You need to keep your hands in plain sight. You can use the blanket, but please don't pull it higher than your waist, the nurse said. Morgan reluctantly let the blanket slip. The security guard at the door stood, hands clasped in front of him and looking straight ahead. Morgan wasn't sure who he was there to protect, but his presence made her feel threatened. It made her stomach feel empty and her heart pound. Ethic had told her this wouldn't be like punishment, but as she stared at the gun on the man's hip, she felt like she was trapped. She just wanted to go home. No one made her feel safer than Ethic. She just wanted to get out of there. The nurse removed the strap from her duffel bag and then placed it on the table. You'll change into these, she said, placing folded tan scrub-like clothing next to the bag. Morgan's eyes burned. This felt permanent. It felt like more than a 3-day evaluation. Why does she need a uniform if she wasn't staying? Had Ethic committed her without her knowledge? Can I call home? She asked, her voice trembling in terror. Not right now, Morgan. There's a schedule you must adhere to here, the nurse informed. If you want to climb in the wheelchair, I'll take you up to the psych floor. Get you settled. I don't want to get settled. I won't be here long. 3 days, and I feel fine. I can walk, Morgan answered. It's protocol. You must be escorted in the wheelchair onto the psych floor. The psych floor? They thought she was crazy. She was being handled like she was crazy. Messiah took my heart and my mind. It's with him. Wherever he is, it's there, next to him. Messiah, I need you. Where are you? You promised me I need you, and you're not here. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. This is. Cannot with these kids. I don't even know what to say. Like, I'm just. Do you even fucking I don't know. All right. Let me just keep going, y'all. Listen. Oh, wait a minute. Hey, Dimples. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. She gonna say, well, she is a little batshit. Nah, child, she just a girl in love. And when you consider that, hell, being in love is enough to drive anybody crazy. But when you couple that with all the loss this child has been through and all the trauma she's endured, remember, at her 6th birthday party, 3 people died in her family's home. And then from there, the deaths just keep on coming. Her daddy, her mama, her sister, right? Then she gets assaulted, not once, but twice in the same night on her 18th birthday. Like, yeah, it's a lot. Hell, I think all of us would have a couple screws rattling around in our fucking toolbox if that shit happened to us like that, like just back to back law. And many of us have had that, things like that happen. And somehow or another, we just managed to make it through. But that doesn't necessarily mean that shit. That just means traumatized. Yeah, she just needed some therapy. That's all. She needs some therapy, poor baby. Lord have mercy. All right, here we go. I know I made promises, Shorty. I know I said shit to hurt you. I know I'm fucked up. I told you I was fucked up. Why I gotta be so fucked up? I should have never touched you, never loved you. I can't fucking take hurt like this, Shorty. What did you do to me? The thoughts ran through his head. They had been running through his head for weeks, almost like he could hear Morgan's thoughts, like he was responding, sending a response through midair and planting them right into her mind without speaking one word. Two lovers so connected that they were having one-sided conversations that made sense. Two young souls so attached that the pain they had caused one another was shared. They could feel it. They had manifested it, and it was killing them. Two hearts fused so tightly together that ripping them apart had proved deadly. Messiah sat in the waiting room of the hospital, head bowed as he gripped the manila envelope in his hand. The huge cross that hung above him caused his lip to tremble. God, please, I know I put in a lot of work for the other side. I know, man. I know I'm fucked up. I know this prayer fucked up too, but gave me something that was fucking beautiful, man. And I just need a little more time with her to be able to let her know I'm sorry, to show her why I'm fucking insane in the head over her. She don't even know how good she is, man. Messiah scoffed, shaking his head as he curved the envelope in his hand, turning it into a cylinder that he gripped tightly. You put an angel down here just for me, and she has no idea she even belongs to you. Just give me time with her. Please, man, I ain't even fuck with you like that until you gave me her. She's the only thing you ever gave me that made shit down here easier. Don't take her away. Just give me more time. I need her. Messiah had never been this weak. He didn't even recognize the feeling. He had thought the hardest times of his life had passed him by, but they had failed in comparison to this. Mr. Williams, Messiah turned to the door to find a nurse staring at him. We're ready for you now. Messiah felt his stomach sink. This was it. This was what he had avoided for months. He stood and followed the woman into the back. Stand on the scale, the woman said. Messiah stepped up onto the metal plate. When's the last time you've seen your doctor? The nurse said, frowning. Messiah thought back, his mind floating back in time to the day he'd taken Mo to Stepping Stone Falls to let her high come down. That morning, he found out that morning he had been diagnosed with cancer. It was the biggest reason he had warned Morgan that he would never be able to stay, that he would hurt her, that they would never be. There was no future with him, no wedding, no growing old together. He knew that it would hurt her to only have him for a little while, but that small moment of time that they had carved out was the best days of his life. Those days outweighed every ounce of pain he had ever felt. He looked at his illness as a blessing because he would have never crossed the line with Morgan if he hadn't been diagnosed that day. Hearing that he was sick made him want to risk what little time he had left on her. Messiah couldn't allow himself to die without indulging in an angel. Morgan had been his biggest blessing, and he had been her biggest curse. This nigga got cancer, bro? Come on, man. Is she gonna get wheeled past him at the hospital, and then that's how they gonna see each other, and then that's how she gonna, he gonna, he, look, I can't even fucking talk. That's how he gonna, she gonna, like, how is it? Lord, hamburger and french fries. I am, oh, Jesus. I don't even know what to say. This is insane in the membrane, Jack. Oh. She would never know how sorry he was. He would never be able to tell her. It's been a while, about a year or so, he said. You're 180 pounds, according to your records from your doctors in Michigan. You were 225 at your last visit. Okay, so two different hospitals. Damn. You know what that means, right? They should have told you what to look for, the signs. You should have. I know, he said. I was busy living. I didn't want to take the time out to die. I found a girl to love me for a little while. It was worth it. Wow, man. Come on, son. This ain't even happening, bro. This ain't right, y'all. I just feel, Okay, Ashley, now I'm pissed off. Oh, my God. All right. Messiah stepped down and the woman looked at him in stern. Let's get you in a room, the woman whispered, clearly affected, barely audible. She cleared her throat and led the way down a hallway and then into a private room. He opted for the chair in the corner. He didn't want to see the little leather bed that was for patients. He wanted no parts of any of this, but he had promised. He had promised Blue to meet her there. On my fucking nerves, man, he thought, shaking his head. As soon as the thought manifested in his mind, there was a knock at the door. It opened, and he saw her peek through. Messiah, she whispered, a bit of relief in her tone as she pushed the door open all the way, stepped inside. She laughed a little, scoffing in disbelief. Stop being dramatic, man. I said I would show up, he said. Blue laughed a little more, swiping her tears away. I'll give you 2 a minute. The doctor will be in soon. As soon as the door was pulled closed, he stood and she ran into his arms. She couldn't help but sob. I didn't think he would come, Blue said. Messiah pulled back. I'm here, man. That's the first step, she answered. You could beat it, you know? There's a reason I borrowed all that money from Iman to pay for this. Some fucking Christmas gift, Messiah stated, shaking his head as he sat down in the chair. His head hung in turmoil and Blue reached for his locks, pulling until Messiah looked up at her. Why are you here, Blue? You know who I am. You know I ain't shit. I fuck up everybody around me. You stay long enough, I'm gonna hurt you too, he said. So I'm supposed to run from you, Messiah? She asked. I'm supposed to abandon you? Yeah, that's exactly what you're supposed to do, B, he said. Self-preservation. A nigga ain't shit. You're everything, Messiah, she whispered. You saw so much good in me when I was at my worst. I'll never forget that. I'll never not see the good in you. I don't care how much bad you try to cover me with. Don't ever bring nobody here, he said stubbornly, chin quivering as he reached for her, pulling her close and burying his head in her stomach. Nobody, B, not Issa, not Meek, and especially not Morgan. Don't ever bring her. I don't ever want her to see me sick. Blue was hesitant to touch him because she was afraid that it would remind him that he was exposing himself. If he remembered that he was showing vulnerability, he would stop. This shit is gonna hurt, B. I can already feel it. I've been feeling it, he admitted. Been dying. The shit is killing me, and it's like every day I breathe a little different, a little bit less every day. Blue placed a delicate and shaking hand to his head. Her fingers explored his locks, massaging his scalp as he placed both hands to her hips, burying his face into her body. She felt him shudder, but she didn't hear the sob that accompanied it. She knew he was holding it in with all the strength he had left. Messiah Williams hated to be weak. He hated this, showing her this, but he couldn't help it because she was all he had left, the only person capable of coming with him. The last man standing on his team was a woman. Ain't that a bitch? That's always the way it is, my G. I'm so sorry, Messiah, she whispered as a tear trailed down her cheek and fell through midair, landing in his hair. Her tears watered him. She was raining emotion, and she hoped her flood would nourish him enough to grow. The thought of Messiah dying tore Blue up inside. She had been through this before, the loss of a great man. She dreaded the grief that was to come. The only thing that had kept her from giving in to addiction when she had felt it before had been Messiah, his friendship, his insistence on showing up for her. But if he became the one she mourned over, who would keep her together? Blue could already feel herself falling apart. A polite knock on the door forced Blue to take a step back, and Messiah pinched the bridge of his nose, clearing his throat. A black woman with blonde locks entered the room. She had too much hope in her eyes to be an oncologist. I'm Dr. Autumn Nash, she said. Messiah, he stated, and you're his friend, Blue finished for her. Blue Montclair. She's the unlucky motherfucker who gets to watch me die, Messiah said. Well, she seems to love you very much, Dr. Nash answered. Yeah. She likes torturing herself, Messiah snapped. Messiah, stop, Blue whispered. It's okay, Dr. Nash spoke. I'm sure it's been a hard thing to wrap your mind around. There are stages of acceptance that patients must go through. Anger is one of them. Resentment, too. I ain't none of those. I don't even want to be here, Messiah stated. I'm just trying to speed this shit up. Get it over with. Everybody gotta die one day. Well, Messiah, I'd like to do all I can to try to slow this down, if you're willing to let me try, Dr. Nash said. Dr. Nash clicked the lights and pulled out a scan before turning on a monitor that illuminated the images she hung on a monitor. These are the scans from the last time you were seen by your doctors in Michigan, the woman stated. She switched the images. This is you now. Oh, Messiah, Blue gasped. She felt the squeeze on her hand and it surprised her. She didn't hesitate to lace her fingers through his and hold on tightly. They would need to hold on because the ride was about to get bumpy and he had no one else to hold him down. As you can see, the cancerous cells have spread drastically, Dr. Nash said. I'd like to cut it out. She turned on the light. Nah, man, they already told me. You cut and I'm dead. They said it's a 3% chance that I come off the table alive. Look at that shit, man. How do you cut all that out? Messiah asked. With skill. With patience, it'll be a very long surgery. I have a team in Baltimore at Hopkins that I trust to assist. We could airlift you there and have you in surgery in days, Dr. Nash answered as she sat on the rolling stool in front of Messiah. The chances are very dismal, Messiah. I won't lie to you, but I am the very best. There's a reason why people come to me from all over the world. With me, your chances go from 3% to 20%, the woman answered. A 20% rate of survival. He would have surgery and the cancer could be gone. You could get it all? Blue asked. I could. Then I'd run him through intense chemotherapy treatments. It'll be miserable. I won't lie to you. Then, for good measure, radiation as well. But you'd be alive. It'll be the toughest time of your life, but it's a shot. So I either die fast and use the time how I want to, or die slow and let you carve me apart, Messiah said. I don't want to die on an operating table. 20% isn't enough. Nah, I'm not having the surgery. Messiah, let's think about this. Ain't shit to think about. It's my body, my life beat. If I'm gonna take a L, I'm gonna do it my way. The doctor nodded. Okay, let's get you through intake and check in. We'll begin normal rounds of chemotherapy. We'll try to attack as many of these cells as we can. Give you all the time we can, Messiah, without surgery. How long? Blue's voice barely worked, but she had to know. 3 months. Four, if we're lucky, Dr. Nash said. It felt like the clock began ticking at that very moment, a countdown to doomsday. Blue's eyes prickled in distress. I know it's a lot. I'll give you some time to process things. A nurse will be in to escort you to your room. I gotta stay here? He asked. At this stage, it's wise to continue fighting the disease in hospice. It's time you make some preparations, Messiah. I'm sorry. Messiah broke. His head collapsed between his knees, but he quickly recovered, lifting his head high as he stood, his face convulsed, betraying him, exposing him. Blue stepped in front of him, grabbing both hands. She brought his hands to her heart. It was racing. She was wrecked. Her entire body trembled. She was so devastated, but he didn't need weakness. He needed strength. He was terrified. She could see it, so she couldn't show that she was too. Look at me, Messiah, she whispered. I ain't did shit right, B, and I ain't got time to fix it, he said. If I've ever hurt you, Blue. You haven't, Messiah. I have, B. I saw you down bad. I saw you on the block, strung out, and I served you. I poisoned you more, Blue. I don't even know why you here. How you put up with me all these years? You should be gone too. You know why I've stayed clean all these years, Messiah? She asked. He shook his head, unable to even form words. Because I knew you were coming by for breakfast, for dinner. Because your ass don't cook and you can't live off fast food, she said, snickering through tears that blinded her. Sometimes for nothing. Sometimes just to feed Savior when he was first born. Sometimes just to look me in my eyes. I knew you were coming by, so I couldn't get high. I couldn't backslide. I couldn't let my emotions drown me because you were always on your way over. You would call at 6 in the morning sometimes and not show up until dinner. So I couldn't. I couldn't get high all day because you were on your way, always there. Even when I didn't want you there, you came anyway. We're connected through someone we both lost. Your best friend was my best friend, and we lost him. And we've been stuck together ever since. You've done his job ever since, Messiah, and I love you for that. Not the shooter, not the goon, not the crazy nigga with a temper and a street resume a mile long, but my friend. I know you think you're heartless, Messiah, but you have shown me love in ways that prove you aren't. I don't know anyone better than you. Just because you've done bad things doesn't mean you haven't given out good too. I'm not going to let you believe that lie. You have been the very best friend to me, Messiah. It's my turn to be that to you. Messiah opened one hand over her heart and ran it up to her neck. Blue was at his mercy. He could squeeze the life out of her if he wanted, and she knew he wanted to. Messiah handled pain by inflicting pain. He was frustrated. He had a taste for murder. He wrapped one large hand around her neck while staring at her. Blue stepped into him and wrapped her arms around his waist, laying her head on his chest as he rested his chin on top of her head. Fucking annoying, B, he complained. Blue burst out into laughter as he held her tightly. They had such a hard road ahead of them, but Messiah was grateful for her presence. He was already dying without Mo, but Blue made it a little better. She made it a little less lonely, and as he stood there, holding her in his arms, he realized that Morgan Atkins may have been the love of his life, but he hadn't loved her first. Blue had cracked through his shell long before. He just hadn't realized how valuable her friendship had been to him until now. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. That's fucked up. I don't even know no other way to put it, Jack. That is fucked up. Damn. Come on. I don't even know what to Y'all feel some type of, like, I don't want Messiah to die like that. Come on, y'all don't even. All right, player to player, pimp to pimp. Fuck it. We got to keep on pushing because this is some bullshit, yo. I almost want to stop reading right here. Like, that's fucked up, yo. I'm annoyed. All right, which one of y'all again was it that told me to read this shit? Right, K. Nigga got cancer, bro. That's fucked up. And Nordic, your punk ass knew and ain't even say shit. She like, you told me not to say nothing. it's trash. Right, that part, sis. That's what I'm saying. Like that part right there. I need him to know about his child so he'll fight. So he'll get the surgery and the chemo and the radiation. He gonna lose his locks of love, but they grow back. You know, they'll grow back. I mean, damn, yo. Damn. I'm mad. Man. All right, we gonna find out together. What the hell he do? 'Cause this is annoying, y'all. This is I'm like I don't even know what to do. I feel like my little heart is breaking, y'all. All right, let me I gotta wet my whistle or something. Plus, not to y'all, I done been through a lot today. My son done had me drinking this vomitous ass coconut water, talking about it's got electrolytes, it'll hydrate you, it's gonna help you, mom. He's such a fucking weirdo, all healthy and shit. Like, what the fuck is that? That shit tastes like elephant pee. I just can't stand it. But I came up with an idea for him to mix it with the cran grape juice, and then I couldn't taste it, but it's got to be super cold because that shit just like, bleh. Y'all drink coconut water? It's disgusting. Me no like it. I don't like it at all. Right, let me keep going because y'all didn't come over here to hear about my damn health journey, child. Listen. People be like, I didn't come here for this shit. Okay, well, bye then, hell. I told you, this is not an app. If you're looking for shit that's just like straight through reading, fuck out of here, because this ain't that, pimp. Like, goodbye. Make sure you slam the door on your way out. We talk about everything in the middle of these chapters over here, from asshole to appetite, as my auntie used to say. From asshole to zebra nuts and everything in between, you heard me? Right. So you don't know what the fuck you might get over here in the middle of a fucking book, okay? It is, that's just the way it shit shake out over here. But what kind of story would that be? Would what be? For him to find out about his baby and fight? It would be the greatest love story ever told. That he will fight for his baby. For both his babies. For his baby girl, Morgan, and his baby son. I don't know. I guess she would name him Messiah Jr. or whatever the fuck. Which is, I think it's weird. Don't no nigga need to have no baby named after him. Give that child an identity of its own. I say that all the time, but y'all don't hear me though. Stop naming y'all kids after they raggedy ass daddies. I don't care how great you think he is. Give that child the opportunity to develop his own shoes to walk in, not feel like he gotta fill in the shoes of his daddy. You know, I gotta be a better version of my daddy. I gotta be just like my daddy. No, you don't. You gotta be you. The universe made you. Your mama just decided to name you after your ugly ass daddy. No, God. And I know that sounds ignorant as hell, but trust me. Children who are named after their daddies feel like they gotta do the same shit their daddy did. Just look at all the little juniors. Don't they grow up to be fucked up versions of their own damn? Well, some of them be better versions, but they try to walk in their daddy's footsteps. No, No, make your own fucking tracks. No God. All right, I done passed my damn time stamp up. Here I go. Y'all know I'm right. Shit. Kids out here fucked up trying to be their damn daddy. Fuck that nigga. All right, here we go. Chapter 6. Alani rolled over, and the vacancy beside her caused her eyes to pop open. Ethic was gone, missing from the spot beside her. She knew because she was unsettled. They slept so intertwined with one another that too much space felt foreign. She was roused from her dreams because his hot skin wasn't overheating her. She complained about how hot his body always seemed to be, but she secretly loved it, silently adored the warmth he covered her with at night. It was cold in this empty room. A chill had settled over the entire house, in fact. It had only been 24 hours, and the mood in the Oklahoma home was dismal. From Ethic to his children, everyone was cloaked in angst. Alani placed nude painted toes to the floor and reached for the robe hanging off the back of the bathroom door. The matching version was on the hook beside it, and even that subtle detail made her smile. His and hers bathrobes. He had purchased her one to stop her from hogging his. She covered herself and eased out of the room. She took the top floor of the house by memory. It was like she had designed it herself, the way she maneuvered around the plant in the hallway and the hutch that sat against the wall to get to Easy's room. She pushed open the door and found Easy pointing a laser pen at the glow-in-the-dark stars that were stuck to his ceiling. "Hey, big man," she whispered as she stepped inside. "What are you doing awake?" "I can't sleep. I keep dreaming about Mo and my mom," Easy said. "Well, that doesn't sound like such a bad dream," Alani answered. "It's a nightmare. If Mo is with my mom, then that means she's dead too. It means she's never coming home," Easy answered. It was like he had put a dart through her heart. "Oh, Easy," Alani sighed. She walked over to his bed. "Scoot over." Easy made room for Alani, and she laid down next to him, staying on top of the cover while he was nestled underneath. "Mo is coming home. She's going to be back here safe and sound before you know it," Alani said. "And you know, dreams don't really work like that. You can dream about people who are no longer with us and people who are, Easy. It doesn't mean Mo is going anywhere. Your mom is probably with Mo right now, watching out for her to make sure she's all right. You don't have to be afraid to dream about them together." "Are you sure?" Easy asked. "I'm sure," she said. "Can you sleep in here with me? If you're next to me, maybe you'll show up in my dream too. I really want my mom to meet you." Alani nodded, and she was grateful for the darkness because he couldn't see the tears that accumulated in her eyes. Alani knew that Ethic was the man for her, but he wasn't her favorite. He never could be because the little people in his life held those spots in her heart, and they weren't letting up. Easy was the love of her life. The unknowing way he loved on her was unlike anything she had ever experienced. That mother and son bond he gave her was flawless. "I'd really like to meet her too. I'll stay right here until you fall asleep," she whispered. She turned her face to kiss the top of his head. She began to hum. "I release all disappointment from my mental, physical, spiritual, and emotional body. Because I know that spirit guides me and love lives inside me. That's why today I take life as it comes." It was her favorite mantra, an India RE song that always reminded her to let go of what she couldn't control and live for today, to accept what the present brings and let go of the rest. This day brought her motherhood, not for the one she thought she'd spend the rest of her life nurturing, but to a little boy and girl that she had never expected to receive. Alani laid patiently with Easy tucked beneath her. She didn't rush his sleep or try to sneak out early. Her need to check on Ethic had transformed into her need to make sure Easy slept without fear. Easy trumped Ethic every time. His children always would. If she ever had to choose, she would always rescue them first. It was what made Ethic love her. "God, please let me be useful to him," she whispered. She didn't climb out of his bed until 2 hours later, when she was sure he wouldn't stir. Bella was next. She opened the door to find Bella sleeping soundly, and she didn't disturb her. The master bedroom was still empty, and she knew exactly where to find Ethic. She walked down the stairs and into the basement. She would never get used to seeing him like this. Black Nike athletic tights, bare feet, big and ugly because he was a whole man, and shirtless. The evidence that he was king rested between his legs, and Alani's body reacted. Everything about him called a response from her. Her head spun, her nipples peaked, and her clit ached. Alani had to close her eyes and shake her head. He was so damn fine. He was so lean, so strong, and those fucking tattoos just did something to her. The whole reformed gangster thing he had going made her river flood. She knew that no matter how well he hid it, there was nothing reformed about his G. It was always present, like the Holy Ghost. His authority was omnipresent. There was no retiring that, but she appreciated his effort. He was doing all he could to be better for her. He was who he was, and Alani had never met anyone like him. The eight-angle pose he held effortlessly was amazing. The ways he controlled his body was incredible, but the way he controlled his mind was a gift. One she felt privileged to unwrap every day, exploring his depths, soaking up his knowledge. God, she loved him. Ethic, she interrupted. He didn't answer, but she knew he heard her. It's late, baby, she said. Or early, depends on who you ask. Have you slept at all? He took his time coming out of the difficult pose, and every muscle in his body worked until he stood on his feet. Sweat wet him. Alani wanted to drench him. He snatched the towel from the couch and took it to his forehead and then his neck before lifting worried eyes to her. Mo's awake, he said. She's been awake all night. Alani was speechless. How do you know that? I can feel it, he answered, taken aback by the connection they shared. Alani held her breath. She knew he wasn't lying because she felt him that way. She felt his energy for miles and miles. Distance didn't matter. She closed the space between them. She'll be home in less than 48 hours. Might as well be weeks, he said, closing his eyes and pressing his forehead to hers. I know, she whispered, stroking his cheek gently with the back of her hand. Ethic was so heavy, so brooding. She massaged his ear and then moved to the back of his head as he nudged her with his face, baiting her. Alani knew that sometimes Ethic liked her challenge, but today, after all he had endured, he needed her submission. He nudged her again, and she fought her instinct to lead, choosing to follow as she dipped her head back, submitting to his tongue as it invaded her mouth. Come on, she whispered, pulling back and grabbing his hand, forcing him to follow her upstairs. She pulled him all the way into the master bedroom and then to the adjoining bathroom. She reached for the oversized tub and turned on the water, adding lavender bubbles. She could see the wear that life was putting on him. He came out of his workout attire and stepped into the tub. Come here. You going? He asked. I'll be right back, she said with a smile. She returned with a handful of candles and a stick of sage. She lit each candle and placed them around the bathtub and then lit the sage. There's way too much bad energy in this house. It's choking you, she said. I burn sage when I feel like I need to clear my house of bullshit. So you're burning it here? He asked. This is my house, ain't it? She asked. He bit his bottom lip, his eyes slanting in amusement. This is your castle, queen. Burn away, he said, throwing his strong arms over the side of the tub and leaning his head back. She placed it in an... Wait a minute, how did they skip ahead pages? Hold on, y'all. Damn it. Hold on. All right, she placed it in an abalone shell and put it on the counter. Come over here, baby. I'm trying to see something. She smiled and grabbed a sponge before walking over to him, sitting on the side of the tub. I'm a patient man, but I want that, Lenika, he said, reaching for the belt on the roll. She snickered and gripped his chin, forcing him to look at her. She pecked his lips. This isn't that, she said. It should be that, he countered. She dipped the sponge in the water and poured liquid soap all over it before taking it to his back. She washed his skin with one hand and massaged his tense shoulders with the other. He groaned. You have to sleep, Ezra, she said. You can't take care of Mo or anyone else if you don't take care of you. Nobody has ever taken care of you. I won't let you be neglected. She washed his body like she was washing a child, and to her surprise, he complied. He had done this for her, cleansed her. Now she was cleansing him. Mind, body, soul, home, heart. It would all remain spotless under her care. His head hung low as she let water drain from the sponge over his head. He took one hand and cleared the water from his eyes before wrapping both arms around her. Alani's heart was old and raggedy. It was bruised and bullied, but damn if it didn't beat for this name. He had made sure of it. He had resuscitated her. everyone else had given up. She dropped the sponge into the water and cupped his face as he stared up at her. "I'm gonna be so good to you," she promised. "While you handle everything else in our world, I'm gonna handle you. Love you, as long as you let me." He pulled her into the water, robe and all. He slipped the shoulder of the robe down and sunk teeth into her shoulder and then palmed her breast, lifting her nipple to his mouth. Alani's head fell back and she gripped his thigh as he feasted there before moving to the other one. She felt his dick beneath her and she shuddered as he peeled back the robe, tossing the soggy mess of fabric onto the floor. "Come," he said, the order she always followed. "Ride my face, baby." Alani's eyes widened slightly. "Nasty ass," she thought. She stood, hovering over him, as he looked up into her womanhood, exploring, fingering. His strength was remarkable as he picked her up, gripping her hips as she let her thighs plie over him. When his lips touched her, Alani's hands lifted to the wall. He was arresting the pussy. She might as well assume the position. He smacked her ass so hard it stung, and she knew what it meant. He was putting her to work. Alani worked her hips because she knew he wanted her all over his face. "Feed this nigga," she thought. He groaned, sucking on her clit like she used to do Kool-Aid baggies back in the day. Ethic wasn't the man to make a mess while eating. He made sure everything she served went in his mouth. His tongue was just wet enough, not sloppy, not disgusting, but juicy and warm. And the texture of his taste buds against her sensitive clit put a frenzy in her soul. She couldn't ride him hard enough, couldn't quite fuck his face deep enough. Her mind was gone as she chased ecstasy. "Ah," she cried between clenched teeth. She pressed her pussy down so hard on his face, she was sure he couldn't breathe. And she didn't care where the orgasm came from. His lips, his tongue, his nose. She covered all three bases as she went for that home run. His hands gripped her thighs so tightly, she was sure his fingers would leave bruises behind. He lifted her, ran his tongue from her clit to the parts where his tongue shouldn't touch. And he ate her there, too. "This nigga here," she thought. "Oh, my God," she moaned. "Ethic, baby, why do you do this to me?" The way he manipulated her clit made Alani go crazy. She came hard, gripping his head as he sucked her soul from her body. She let one leg fall to the bottom of the tub for balance as he stood. She placed both hands to the wall as she felt him hanging behind her, hot dick on her wet ass. He grunted as he lowered a bit and then split her in half. One stroke straightened her spine as he reached around her body and gripped one breast while devouring her neck. It was sensory overload. It felt too good, sinful. Alani lifted one leg onto the side of the tub as he folded her in half. His hands spread wide over her lower back, fingers lifting as he pulled her back, forcing every inch of him into her. "Ethic, I can't take it," she whispered. "Take it, Lenika. Take care of me, baby," he said, hitting her deeper. Damn, he hit it harder, faster. Alani threw it back, biting down hard to stop her moans because she was going to wake up the entire house. The entire floor was wet and the water had gone lukewarm as Ethic hit the bottom of her depths, daring deeper with every stroke. It was so good that she felt herself running all over him. Shit. Ethic gripped her ass so tightly, going so hard that Alani's legs began to shake. He wrapped an arm around her waist and sat back inside the water, pulling her onto him, reversing their roles, giving her the power because he felt her getting weak while he was in control. A fist to her hair, he pulled her backwards until she leaned her back against his chest. His dick was rooted in her, so long and wide that she felt him everywhere, stretching her limits, breaking her in like a new pair of shoes. Ethic did all the work, still stroking upward as he leaned against the back of the tub while reaching around her body to roll her clit between his coarse fingertips. "Ezra," she whined. "Nut for me," he groaned in her ear. "I am," she cried. "God, I am." She could barely breathe. Bitches had to train for dick like this. Stretch, warm up, and then do a few laps before hopping on because it took endurance to finish this marathon. She felt him pulsing, felt his dick throbbing as he had his way with her. She lifted and turned, not hesitating to put her mouth on him. Sucking dick was personal for a woman, and Alani had hated it before Ezra. You just couldn't eat everybody's food without inspecting the kitchen. Same for Dick. Couldn't wrap your lips around something if you didn't know where it had been. But Alani knew he was for her. She was the only chef in his kitchen, and she waxed that wood until it was shiny and wet. Ethic buckled, stomach caving, abs tensing as he gripped the sides of her head and watched as she sucked the orgasm right out of him. Alani kept going until she tamed him, and then she kissed the tip of him before climbing up his body. Now we sleep, she whispered. She kissed his lips and climbed out of the tub. She placed extra towels on the floor to soak up the water. I'll clean this up when we wake up. Ethic followed her to their room, and as Alani went to pull the curtains closed, she paused. Hints of orange, purple, and yellow blazed against the horizon as the sun ended night's reign. She relaxed into him as he came up behind her, wrapping tattooed arms around her waist. The light always comes after the dark, Ethic. You just have to be patient, she whispered. Morgan's going to get out of there, and you're going to make sure she's strong. Strong, without a man making her strong. We're all going to be okay, he gruffly replied. She knew he was lost in thought, and she placed her hands over his as they stood there staring out the window, watching the sunrise. I love you. He kissed the back of her head, and it was enough. It was all the reciprocation she needed. She was enveloped in his love every second he was in her space, and even when he wasn't, she had never felt anything greater. She just hoped they could get to a place of peace because he deserved it. They had earned it. They just had to get through the dark, and the light would eventually come, just like the sun. They would rise. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Oh, Lord have mercy. This is child. I don't even know. It's a lot, y'all. I know, right? Hey, Marva. Okay. All right. Well, yep. Thank you for hitting the like and catch the replay when you can, darling. All right. Let me get my time stamp for this next chapter, child. Listen, because this is, I hope they get 5 fucking minutes to be happy, but I got a feeling this shit is going to end tragically, and I am not. I'm not going to be happy about it. I'm literally not going to be happy about that. Y'all know it. I know it. Hold on, I can't force it. I don't even know what to say. I'm just annoyed. I know. Every time they have a happy moment, some shit get ready to hit the fan. And I don't want to ask for those of you that have read it already. Like, because I don't want to ruin it. It's all right. Chapter 7. Morgan stepped into her old room. Thank God. Her timid steps and curious eyes took in the luxurious space. It was exactly as she had left it. She had been a girl when she occupied this space. It seemed like so long ago. The months she had spent with Messiah had felt like an eternity. She was a woman now, grown and burdened with the ills of love, like every other woman of the world before her. Men had a way of disgracing a woman, of marking up the walls of her heart, destroying it, and then expecting them to function afterward. Morgan was barely putting one foot in front of the other. She really just wanted to go back to her apartment, but Ethic wasn't having it. He wanted her under his watchful eye. She could see the fear in him. He thought she would try to finish the job if she had enough space and opportunity. There was no convincing him otherwise. You good? He asked as he stood in the doorway, watching her, eyes filled with angst, forehead riddled with lines. Morgan felt bad because she knew he was terrified to lose her. He was terrified to lose everyone he loved. He'd lost so much over his lifetime that he tended to hold on too tight, but Morgan needed that right now. She appreciated that he didn't want to let her go. Messiah had let her go without thinking twice. She needed someone who wanted to tie a knot of loyalty around her. Her father, she needed him. Ethic was that and more. She nodded. I'm fine. I promise, she whispered. Ethic opened the pharmacy bag he held in his hands and removed two orange bottles. His big hands twisted the tops off and he placed two pills on the desk. His eyes prickled as he screwed the tops back on. Morgan could see that he was struggling, and she felt so much remorse that she couldn't bear the sight of him. I'll keep the pills with me. Ethic could barely get the words out. Xanax and sleeping pills. His beautiful Morgan was burdened with pain so great that she had to numb it. Pain so great that he couldn't trust her to keep an entire bottle in her possession. He wasn't pleased with the fact that she was taking them while pregnant, but her sanity was at stake, and the doctors had assured him that the low dosage wouldn't affect her baby. Still, the fact that she needed them at all tore him apart inside. Mo, Ethic started and then stopped, unable to find the right words. I'm sorry, baby girl. Morgan shrugged, her lips so heavy with sadness that they spoke out in effortless pout. It was the face she had made when her heart was broken ever since he had known her. Every other time he had been able to fix it, he couldn't fix this. It made him feel helpless because if he wanted nothing else at all, if he could have one wish, it would be to heal Morgan Atkins. Messiah, Ethic started. I know he's dangerous, she interrupted. He is, Ethic nodded, but he's also tied to you now, so keeping him out of the loop isn't an option, Mo. I don't know where he is, but if he contacts you, let me know. I don't want you around him until I've talked to him. He and I need to come to an understanding about some things. You're going to kill him, Morgan said. She wasn't like Bella. She didn't scare at the notion of Ethic's gangster. She had never been naive to the fact that it existed. Benny Atkins had been a gangster, and she had loved him anyway. Morgan knew exactly who Ethic was, and she loved him more because of it. The notion that girls found boys like their fathers proved true because Messiah reminded her so much of Ethic. For fucking knocking you up, I could wring his fucking neck, Ethic said, but the rest we're forced to work out. There's a kid on the way. I can put ghosts aside for that, but I need to tie loose ends. He was here on behalf of Maison, on behalf of his family. He needs to know that this is the last pass I'm extending until I talk to him, till he knows you aren't to see him, Mo. Just let me make sure his intentions with you are what he says they are. They aren't, Morgan said, shaking her head. If they were, he would be here. I know him. I know him like no one else knows him. Everything he ever said to me was a lie. Morgan's face melted into destruction as she tried her hardest to keep the tears at bay. I loved him and he lied, she cried. Ethic crossed the room and she buried her woes in his chest. He could feel her body quaking and he saw red. Oh, the ways he wanted to peel Messiah's top back, not for targeting him. Ethic had been sent for before. He had faced opposition in the game many times. He could handle that part. The pieces of Morgan that Messiah had broken, that was all the motivation Ethic needed to cover Messiah in 6 feet of dirt. I know, baby girl. Feel that shit and then learn from it, Mo. Use it to become a stronger woman, a stronger mother, Ethic said. I want to talk to you about maybe going back to the hospital for counseling a couple times a week. I know we've tried in the past and you didn't like it, but Morgan pulled back, shaking her head. I don't need that, Ethic. I'm fine. Please don't make me do that. Girl, shit. See, this is that bullshit I'm talking about. Her eyes watered and her lip trembled. Pure fear seized her. She didn't trust many. She didn't trust any, in fact. Just Ethic. Just family. No way could she bear her soul to a stranger. She hadn't said one word over those 3 days. She just sat there, staring at the doctors as they tried to get her to open up. She just bided her time, counting every hour until Ethic came to get her. You tied a pipe to the back of a car, Morgan. That's not fine. Do you know what that would have done to me if you had killed yourself? What it would have done to Bella? Easy? We need you, Mo. Every fucking sip of air that I've taken since you walked into my home has been for you. You may not love you, Mo. You have some things in your past that have jaded your perception of yourself, but I know you love me. I know that. You love me more than you love you. Do you want to kill me, Mo? Never, Morgan cried. You will, Mo. You almost did. If you die, I'm out of here, Morgan. Morgan fucking Atkins, you're my whole damn world. I love Easy. I love Bella, but you? He choked up as his face lost control. He had to grit his teeth to continue. You are the love of my life, Mo. Not Raven, not Alani. You. Is you, Mo. You're a gift. You're a piece of a woman that I'll never have. She trusted me with you, and you have been light in my darkness. You have given me purpose, Morgan. You love me. I need you to love me enough to never hurt yourself again, because if you do, you're hurting me. If you die, I'm dying, Mo. These insecurities you have, they kill me, Morgan. You're my all. There is no family here, no life in this house without you, baby girl, he whispered. Morgan was crying. Her entire face was wet as she looked at Epic. He poured out his heart to her, a love letter she had always wanted, a devotion she had known she had, but somehow didn't believe. She felt it in this moment, and she was guilt-stricken for taking him through hell. It was like Epic had aged in days. Worrying over her had aged him. It had taken time off his life, and she was so sorry. It just doesn't feel that way sometimes. I know you love me. I know you do, but I'm not your blood. What does blood mean, Mo? You ain't gotta be my blood, because you're the fucking heart that circulates it. Blood can leave you just as quick. Blood don't make people stick around. He thought about his father abandoning him without a second thought, and the pain of the memory struck through him like lightning. That don't mean shit, Mo. It's the people who love you back, who stick with you when you're fucking up, when you're being unlovable. Those are the people that count. Men leave every day. Women too. I'm a father to you because you're mine. You're mine because I said you were mine, and I take that commitment seriously. You aren't disposable in my life, Morgan. She was crying so hard that her lip trembled violently, and her nose ran as she twiddled her fingers. Ethic sighed, running his hand down his face in exasperation. He sat on the bed and patted the space beside him. What am I not doing, Mo? What else can I do to show you that I love you? He asked. I don't like her, Mo whispered, unable to look Ethic in the eyes. He didn't have to question the her Morgan was referring to. He knew. He didn't know how to respond to it because he liked her. A whole fucking lot. Morgan shuffled hesitant feet over to him and sat beside him. Her being here, it feels like you're forgetting Ray, and she reminds me of her brother. Every time I look at her, I see him. She almost had your baby. That baby would have been related to everyone here except me. If she gives you a family, I'm no longer family. I'm just alone. She's taking my place. She's erasing Raven. No one will ever erase Raven, Ethic said. Or you. He bent over, elbows to knees, as he pinched the bridge of his nose. It was always something keeping him from her. But of all the reasons he had ever had to not pursue Alani, Morgan was the best one. Nobody matters more to me. No, nobody matters to me more than you, Bella and Easy. You're my children. We may not share blood, but you're mine, Mo. I've had more time with you than Benny and Justine were given. Do you know how lucky I feel because of that? I chose you, Mo. Nobody popped up on my doorstep pregnant, forcing me to stick around. I stuck around for you. Because you're my heart, kid. That smile you hit me with at 6 years old melted me. You mean everything to me. I know you better than anyone, Mo. You belong to me. You're a part of me. You're my daughter. No one can sever that. I do love her, though, Morgan. I won't lie to you about that. But she doesn't replace you, and she's not her brother. I don't even know how the same people who made him made her, because she's nothing like him. Her heart, her intentions are. Ethic paused because he couldn't put into words how far from malice Alani was. All Mo knew was that Alani was related to her rapist and that Alani had shot him. She didn't know the parts that Ethic cherished, the love, the rarity of her spirit, the way she made him feel whole. He didn't want to seem like he was defending Alani. He just wanted to be clear. Me loving her doesn't decrease my love for you. My concern right now is you, getting you through this. I won't have her around here if she hinders your healing. I just want to get you right. I need you to be stronger. I need you to live, Mo. Live the life that Raven was supposed to. You're so much like her, but so different. You're supposed to turn out different. A knock at the door caused him to look up. Alani stood with a plate of food in her hands, her show of love. The way she expressed it when she didn't know what to say, she fed people, their souls, their stomachs. She was filling, she was nourishment. She cleared her throat, and the tenderness in her eyes told him she had overheard. Her feelings were hurt. She was holding it in, trying to be strong. "I have food if you're hungry," she said. Her voice was small as she held up the plate. It held injury in it. Her feelings were hurt, and Ethic knew she had overheard Morgan's distrust. Morgan shook her head. Alani had been there for her after the fight at Messiah's, but Morgan was a stubborn girl. No way would she betray her sister. No way would she let Ethic love Alani more than he loved Raven. She couldn't. She just couldn't. "No thanks." Ethic felt like he was suffocating. He was stuck between the love of his child and the love of a once-in-a-lifetime woman. It felt like they both held onto one of his arms, pulling in opposite directions. God, how he just wanted to walk in the same direction with them, together, his girls, his loves, on one path. That would be too much like right. He sniffed away the burning in his eyes and rubbed his hands on his sturdy thighs and then stood, kissing the top of her head on the way up. He grabbed the plate from Alani's hands and took it to Morgan. "Eat, and then get some rest, Mo." Morgan reluctantly reached for the plate. Ethic paused in the doorway, looking at Mo skeptically. "They told me to strip your room, Mo. Belts, scissors, razors, pins," Ethic said. "I don't want to treat you like that, Mo, but I will if I can't trust you. Can I trust you?" "Yeah," she mumbled. She was mortified. She wondered if this would be what the rest of her life would be like. Would everyone always expect the worst from her? Would they look at her through skeptical eyes forever? "Can I trust you, Morgan?" he asked again. "I'm not going to try to kill myself," she stated louder this time. "You don't have to watch me every second. I just want to be alone." "Just give her a little room to breathe," Alani whispered. "Everybody just needs to take a breath. If she needs you, she'll tell you. Right, Morgan?" "Yeah," Morgan said unenthusiastically. "Right." Alani tugged at Ethic's hand, pulling him out of the room. He pulled Morgan's room door closed on the way out. "I'll head home," Alani whispered. He placed a hand on her face, four fingers wrapping around her neck as he caressed her cheek with his thumb. He could hear her disappointment, but sympathy reflected in her eyes. She understood. It was the reason why she had his heart. She was a mother, first and foremost. Even without any children walking the earth in the physical sense, she still mothered shit, his kids, even him. She had a way about her that illuminated the fact that she had experienced the miracle of having two heartbeats at once. "I just need time to get Mo together. Everything around her is changing. Maybe now might not be the best time for you to move in." Words on his tongue tasted like shit. The impossible choice that Morgan wanted him to make only had one option, his child. Morgan came first. It obliterated his soul. The words, the taking a step forward to be pushed two steps back, tore him apart. He had worked for this. He had hurt for this. Shit. He had bled for this, to get Alani to a place of comfort where she would merge her life with his despite the odds. It was a bitter pill to swallow, their interruption. Possibly their disruption, but Mo needed him. Mo needed him more than he needed Alani, and it was his duty to provide. He could feel Alani holding her breath. She did that when she was in anguish, when an emotion so strong was consuming her, when it was tearing through her like a storm. She held her breath, forgetting that she needed the next sip of it to stay alive. "Breathe," he whispered, and she exhaled while nodding with tear-filled eyes. "We just can't get it right, can we?" she whispered. "I still want this, Lenika," he said. "I just have to get a handle on Mo first. I have to figure out how to do both." A tear fell out the corner of her eye, and he kissed it away. His lips to her face felt amazing. God damn, this woman touched him in ways she couldn't even comprehend. "Okay?" he asked. She nodded. "Of course," she whispered passionately. "Of course, Ezra, she's your daughter." Her understanding made it hurt that much more. He indulged in her lips, and Alani lost strength in her legs. Every single fucking time he touched her, she weakened a bit. One hand wrapped around her waist and went to the cuff of her ass, grabbing, pulling her into him. Time stood still. Time, which waited for no man, somehow slowed a bit for Mr. Okafor. It always did, whenever he was with her, allowing him to savor the moment that would inevitably pass. Her senses heightened for the 10 glorious seconds he helped himself to her tongue. Alani could never fathom how women would just fall victim to the hypnosis of men. She had seen friends switch up and become completely wrapped up in a man, losing all sense of self, and she could never understand it. Until now. Now Alani got it. Now that she had a man capable of making her change up, she felt like a hater for ever being upset about another woman having it, because this nigga here, baby, Alani would lane switch so quick on a bitch. There was nothing that she wouldn't do or give or sacrifice or tolerate to make sure this worked. He released her, and another tear slipped from her eye. She was so damn grateful for him to have survived all they had endured so that she could have him. It was hard, but it was worth it. She was going to feel the loss anyway. Might as well let him love her through it. Let him love her back to health. Love her for the rest of her life, if he chose to put up with her that long, because Alani had her ways, ways that no one else deemed worthy to stick by her through. Then here came Ezra Okafor, sticking and shit, sticking with her through the worst, through it all, sticking like duct tape, like lash glue, like two thick thighs on a sweaty day. Ethic was stuck on her, and it felt glorious. Even with the pain that came with their bond, she would rather love him with all the heartache that came along with it than be carefree with someone else. Back to dating, she said. There was something in her tone, something he couldn't identify. Sadness, disappointment, like he had gotten her hopes up only to pull out. He felt it because it filled him as well, the letdown of it all. I'm not test driving you, Lenika, Ethic said. He kissed her once more, just a peck, to the tip of her nose. Although I wouldn't mind test driving you, baby. She giggled. She didn't even know where it came from. The bubbly snicker that fell off her lips. It was flirty and light and cute. It was everything she would normally roll her eyes at, but he had her floating. Everything he said made her feel like she could fly. I'll take your Tesla, she said. It's probably not a good idea for you to leave her alone to drop me off. I'll be careful with it. Ethic smirked. She was naturally bossy, assertive. He would enjoy breaking her in, dominating her, earning the right to lead her. It took a lot more than good sex to get a woman like Alani to submit. He was up for the challenge. He looked forward to it, in fact. It would take some patience to find their natural roles and then adjust them to each other's comfort level. They had so much to work out. Your Tesla, he corrected as he put the key fob from his pocket and held them up in front of her. What? She frowned. It's yours now. It's a little small for me anyway, he said. I'll call you later. She smiled, then nodded before she took the stairs. She paused halfway. When she turned to him, his eyes were on her. His gaze never left her until distance forced him to look away. He was a man who gave his woman his full attention every time. No staring at a phone screen while she spoke. No half-listening with unenthused responses. He focused on her, not just absorbing her words, but responding to the language her body spoke as well. Should I cancel with Nair tomorrow? No, I'll be there, he answered. Alani continued down the stairs, but his voice halted her once more. I got priorities here, but you're a priority too. One isn't more important than the other. I just have to figure out how to balance it all. This is new for me, juggling a woman and my kids. Nobody's been in your seat before. You loving me back is brand fucking new, Lenika, he said. So, believe me when I tell you, you're at the top of the list, right next to each one of them. I won't miss our session with Nye. I believe you, she assured. He shook his head. Nah, it was a time when you didn't believe in me. I don't want that to happen again. If you can't believe in your man, that ain't your man. You've been mine since the day you rescued me from my job. I believed in you even when I said I didn't, even when you thought I couldn't. I can be stubborn sometimes. There's a lot that comes with me. I know you love the parts I've shown you, but there are others you haven't seen yet. I'm not easy to love, she said. He descended the steps, her words pulling him near, his legs lifting in a confident swagger, causing her eyes to zero in on the dick print enunciated by his Nike sweatpants. She told herself she would burn every single pair he owned when she finally moved in. When she looked up, they were face to face. He trapped her against the wall, his arms making a jail around her as his eyes bore into hers. She wanted to serve a life sentence in this cell. Why the fuck can't I stop tasting her, he thought. He bullied his way into her mouth, kissing her so deeply that she moaned in satisfaction. His thick tongue filled her mouth and she sucked on it, feeling a pulse on her clit. Don't. He pulled her bottom lip into his mouth, pursuing his full lips around hers. Want. He pinned both of her hands against the wall above her head as he focused on her top lip, licked the valley above it. Oddest place, but somehow he made it pleasure filled, easy. He pulled back and pecked her chin and then wrapped his lips around her chin, licking her, tasting her in the oddest place. Another quick kiss to her lips before he nudged her head to the side with his face and trailed kisses down her neck until arresting those hands above her. I could never live without this. I don't even know why I ever tried, she moaned. My God, Ethic, you're gonna make me. Her mouth fell open in bliss. How he had assigned a new recipe to her orgasms, she didn't know. She had needed the same ingredients to get her there her whole life, and Dick was the main one, but Ethic finessed her in ways that just made that oven heat instantly. No waiting, no penetration needed. With him, she came on sight. He wasn't even using his hands, and Alani was climbing the walls. He kissed her like he was afraid to lose her, like her tongue was his favorite candy and he had a sweet tooth. Hardness pressed against her belly, and he scooped her hands under her ass, leaning into the wall, his chest against hers. The friction against her clit had her delirious. The audacity of him to be this bold in the stairway with his children spread throughout the home. She wanted to protest, but she was held hostage by euphoria. He had her mind gone. In one way or another, she was never truly sane with him. She had been crazy in love, lust, or hate with him since the day they had said hello. She couldn't quite seem to find sanity. The way he made her feel, she didn't want to. They had so much fucking to make up for that their every interaction was erotic. A kiss couldn't just be a kiss. It ended up with him inside her every time, and she found it mind-blowing that he kissed her clit the same way he did her lips. He didn't play with it. He didn't approach it like he was afraid of it. He kissed that kitty with aggression, with wanting, and Alani was desperate to have him between her thighs. They lost time as they hid there like two lovesick teenagers groping one another. She couldn't ever recall kissing anyone like this or even enjoying it enough to allow it to last so long. Her panties were destroyed like they were made of paper towel and she had tried to absorb a huge mess. Nobody had ever aroused her like this man. She dripped for him. Daddy! He groaned, and she snickered as their lips separated. They had been kissing for so long that hers throbbed a little. He gripped her face, using his thumb to trace her lips. She opened her mouth, licking his thumb, and Ethic grunted in awakening. The shit I want to do to you, Ethic whispered, as if it pained him to stop. Daddy! Easy was persistent. Never mind, Dad. Ethic went back in for a kiss, but just before their lips touched, Alani! Alani slid out of Ethic's entrapment. Yo, I swear that boy needed ass whooping, Ethic stated. Alani lifted a brow in amusement. You leave him alone, she snickered. I'll check on him on my way out. I gotta go meet my professor, and thanks to you and your little half-hour makeout session, I'm late, she said. She pointed at the erection he was instinctively gripping with one hand. You go handle that. You already late. Might as well be late as fuck. There's only one way to handle this, he insinuated. She took one step and was pulled back into him, only this time he didn't kiss her. He fisted her hair and pulled. Her neck snaked backwards. Her eyes met. So much passion. Lovers unable to depart without it hurting just a bit. I love you. Alani blushed and her heart went tender. Her smile was uncontainable as she returned, I love you. No two on the end of her sentiments, no saying it just to say it because he had said it first. She loved him. She had loved him before he had ever known she loved him, and she meant those three words with every fiber of her being. Come back to me, he said. Her brows pinched as the words penetrated. He's afraid that I'll run. Every time I walk out the door, he's going to wonder if I'll return. Her heart cracked right down the middle. She could see the apprehension behind those soulful eyes. I will, she promised. Ezra, I always will. Every step she took made her feel sick because she didn't want him to have the insecurity of her leaving. She knew what that felt like. She had lived with that her entire life. From her mother to her father, they always left. No one ever stayed. No one but him. He was the only one who loved her enough to do so. As she beelined for the living room, she found Easy on his video game. "What's up, big man? What's with the yelling?" she asked. "I'm starving," Easy said. "There's food right in the kitchen, Easy," she said. "But I don't want that," Easy protested. Alani's eyebrows lifted. Coming up with Nanny, options hadn't been an option. You ate what she cooked. Alani was cut from an old school rearing, so these protests were new to her. She looked to Bella, who sat in a chair with her earbuds in. "Did you eat?" Bella nodded. "Yes, but Easy's super picky," she explained. "Does he have food allergies or something?" Alani asked, confused. Bella pulled out one earbud. "No, he just hates anything that isn't pizza or nuggets. Lily usually makes him a separate meal," Bella explained. Ethic has lost his mind, Alani thought. "Come on, big man," Alani said as she made her way into the kitchen with Easy in tow. She pointed to the island. She was really going to be late now, but this was her new normal. Easy, Bella, Ethic, and even Morgan. If she was going to be a part of it, they had to do some adjusting, too. "Have a seat," she said. She fixed him a plate of the meal she'd made. Baked chicken, Caesar salad, mashed sweet potatoes, and macaroni and cheese. She placed it in front of him. "I spent a lot of time and put a lot of love into making that for you. You don't have to eat everything if you don't like it, but you should try everything at least once. Does that sound fair?" Easy picked at his plate as Ethic rolled into the kitchen. "Dad, can I just have a peanut butter and jelly sandwich?" Easy asked, frowning as he eyeballed the plate. Ethic went to answer, more than likely to oblige, but Alani interrupted. "No, you may not, Easy. I cook every single day. I'm going to be here sometimes, which means I'll be cooking for you." Ethic knew this would not go well. He had been accommodating Easy's palate since he was a baby. Lily knew his favorites and made them every day like clockwork. "But I don't like this stuff," Easy complained. "I think we have chicken nuggets or something, eat." The look Alani gave him stopped Ethic in his tracks, and he held up hands of surrender as he leaned against the countertop. He would be a spectator in this bout. Alani versus Easy. He was curious as to how it would end. "You can't dislike what you haven't tried, baby boy," Alani said. "We can come up with a menu together, and you can choose one dish every meal that you want me to make. But I'm only cooking one meal for everyone in this house. We'll eat together all at the same time, and we'll all enjoy the same meal. Today, this is all that I prepared. So if you're hungry, you'll have to try new things. After you eat, you can ride with me to run my errands, and then we'll go to the grocery store to put together the dinner menu for the rest of the week." Alani held out her hand. "Okay?" Easy squared off with the plate, frowning, and then he nodded. "Okay," he agreed. They shook on it, and she motioned for the plate, holding up crossed fingers. "Go ahead and try it out." Easy took a small bite and chewed, skeptically. "I guess it's edible," he said as he dug in for a second and larger bite. Alani laughed. "I'll take edible." Ethic crossed his arms and looked on in wonder. "Yo, you got some shit with you. Some voodoo doll stashed somewhere or something. I don't know how you do what you do," but he shook his head. "He's eaten the same five foods his entire life, and one conversation with you when he cooperates. I don't play those type of games with my kids. I speak, they listen," she said. Her kids. He noticed the pride that she expressed when she said it. She was staking claim, not forcefully, not trying too hard to insert herself into his life. She moved naturally around his home, correcting and adjusting things that she felt were awry. He had seen Dolce try to attempt the same with Easy and Bella before. Her tone was always too sugary to be real. She tried too hard, sucked up a bit too much, and it never resonated with him as real. His children had resisted her every step of the way, to the point where Ethic had to ask her not to attempt to parent them. Alani was simply mothering. She was making a home out of his house, making admirers out of his children, and making a better man out of him, apparently, he said, impressed, and I'm taking him with me. That way, you know, I have to return, she whispered. We'll stay the night at my place. I'll meet you, Bella, and Mo at church tomorrow. Maybe Nair can do a group session with everyone. Family counseling? The question was rhetorical, and she could see him retreating inside his head to consider the notion. They weren't technically a family, but she loved him, and he loved her. She loved his kids, and they loved her. Morgan hated her, but Alani hoped to work on that. Is that okay? Alani asked. Yeah, I think that's okay, he answered, his eyes taking her in with such intensity that she looked away. Ethel kissed her lips, and Alani headed back toward the front of his home. I'll be in the car when you're done, Easy, and rinse your plate and put it away before you come out. Ethic's eyes followed that ass all the way to the door. Hey, Daddy. Oh, no. That's the wrong tense. Hey, Daddy. Ethic turned his attention to Easy. Are you going to marry her? Easy asked. Ethic blew out a breath of unease. I don't know if she would agree to that, homie. Right now, we're just feeling things out. You should ask her. I'll bet you $100 that she says yes, Easy said. You're that confident, huh? Ethic snickered. Yep, you should just man up and ask her already, Easy said. Not you should just man up. This little nigga here, boy. Ethic's eyebrows rose in amusement. Man up, huh? Easy nodded, stuffed a few forkfuls of food in his mouth, and then hopped up from the table. He was halfway out the kitchen, running full speed before he slid to a stop, ran back to the table, and grabbed his plate. He stunned Ethic once more by clearing the dish from the table, putting it in the dishwasher, and then rushing out. Bye, Dad! Man up, Ethic thought. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't even, why does it keep saying it's only 1 minute after this next chapter? Oh, because it is short. I was about to get the fuck out of here on y'all asses. All right. Yeah, it's not that long. All right, let me get this next time stamp. All right, let me see what y'all say. Yeah, she is selfish, and I need her to not fucking act a fucking donkey with this bullshit because I want to punch her in her fucking throat. Hold on, y'all. Okay, let me see here. Yeah, she's selfish as fuck. And one thing ain't got shit to do with the other. Go ahead and just put the shit in the thing, son. All right. So, yes, heavy meat, sweatpants. Yes, God. Yes, child. I don't allow the wearing of gray sweatpants. Nope, ain't no going outside with that. Put your slacks on and lay that meat right in them boxer briefs. I don't need nobody catching a wink and a blink and a nod. No God. Fuck out of here. I don't know. I'm a weirdo like that, but I just don't think men, well, I don't think married men or men with a woman, you know, should be walking around with their dick swinging around in fucking sweatpants and shit. I don't like that shit. That shit disrespectful as fuck. I remember doing my residency. There was this one doctor. He was from Florida. Child, that nigga had a fucking, I don't know, he had a goddamn RV in his pants. And I don't think that nigga wore drawers. And it seemed like his fucking scrubs was just, I don't know, I don't know if they was like a size too small or what, but it was like he was just trying to hit a home run every time he walked, and it was just very distracting. Like you would try to say, you know, to look in his eyes to issue your greetings and salutations, but like we have eyes and they were made to see. And like you just like, is that like a toddler in there? Like, what are you doing? That's like a whole person in there. I need you to tape that down or wrap it around your waist or something. Like, do something with it. It's just kind of just running amok in your face. And like he would call your name from all the way down. He'll be all the way down the hallway. Hey, Spocky, now you gotta look at this dick just slapping his leg, just slapping it. The whole fucking time he was talking, just slapping, slapping, slapping. Like, I don't know what the fuck. I'm like, what am I saying? Where am I supposed to look? So I'm watching this thing just play up on his fucking side. You try to find his eyes, but your dick be like, bring your gaze back here. I'm down here. I'm like, God damn. Child, and listen, the nurses at the nurses station wasn't shit. They be like, ooh, here he come. Like, everybody would be looking at him. Patients distracted, staff distracted. I'm like, oh my God. Does your wife, like, does she know, like, is she looking when you leave out the door like that? Because it's just, it's too much meat. What do you do with that? Like, how? I don't understand. It was just, oh, just bigly big. It was, I was like, oh, God. Oh, it's crazy, child. Yes, it was like an RV in his pants. It was just, I was like, that shit is too big in the scrubs, right? And he, I mean, listen, you know, scrubs come in all different colors. And it would have been nice if he would have found the black ones, but he didn't. Listen, black and burgundy are great for hiding heavy meat. And they're great for, you know, because when you got a lot of ass, you know what I'm saying? So yes, black and burgundy, my favorite colors. But this nigga always had like the bright colors, the motherfucking, the greens and, you know, the orange ones, just looking like a walking dick. I'm just like, nobody even knows that you have a face, sir. Nobody. All they see is your dick. It's just, I mean, it's so distracting because I'm just like, I know he think everybody want to fuck him. And no, because I'm scared of dick that big. That, oh my God, that looks like you would just be ripped in half. Just, you going to meet your maker on a dick that big. It was just insane. Like, I bullshit you not, y'all. That thing was big. It was like, I don't even know how to just describe it. I'm going to find something. Listen. Imagine two Pepsi cans sitting on top of each other. It looked dangerous. It looked dangerous. I'm scared. I was scared. I'm like, uh-uh. Yeah, he knew exactly what the fuck he was doing. Not a man in sweats just walked on. Child, that shit looked dangerous as fuck. I mean, it's insane. I knew a girl once. She was like, I'm a Sagittarius, baby. I can handle a Coke can. Well, go ahead on, girl. Just be a Sagittarius fan, child, because I'm going to tell you right now, I don't fuck around with nothing. You ain't finna fucking have my shit looking like a cough. Just, no. Coochie just coughing. Just wide open. Fucking, no, God. I can't. I'm not doing that shit. No, it is scary. It's like a horror movie. It was just big. I was like, this, if that's his dick, that's tragic. Like, does he wrap a towel around it or something? Like a big ass bath towel wrapping around. Like, that thing was just too big. No, you don't want to see that in person. Oh, you said the guy in the sweatpants, he wasn't slanging, just mediocre. Child, he might be a grower and not a shower. Those will fool you, child. They sneak up on you like a Long Island iced tea. You just be sipping and sipping and sipping, then try to stand your ass up, child. Yeah, okay. Oh, my God, child, that dude ain't had no fucking face. He was all dick, I promise you. I promise you. She said, that's why I said to look. Yes, a big dick like that will have your poopy hanging. Right, wizard sleeves. You'll be flapping every fucking way you go. Be having to duct tape your lips together. I'm going to hell. y'all fucking with y'all. Oh my God. Oh, child, listen. Yes. Hanging all the way out. Do you hear me? Put your panties on and see that your drawers be talking. Now, bitch, I know you lying. Shit. The fuck you think I'm supposed to do? Yes, dude might have been a grower, child. Wait a minute. Girl, listen. I'd be like, what's the matter with it? I don't understand. Why is it do? They supposed to, you know, like. Listen. I'm like, why she got wizard sleeves? She got choir robe sleeves, you know. Oh, child, listen. Oh, my God. Now I'm going to have women going into plastic surgery to get their wizard sleeves clipped, child. Oh, my God. It takes all coochies to make the world go round, okay? I'm not shaming nobody's coochie. We're not coochie shaming nobody. Mm-mm. We're not doing that. Mm-mm. We don't know that lady's story, child. Listen, we don't know her story. No God. Wait a minute. Nordic said, I got headphones on, but I keep looking around like somebody can't hear you. I'm at work. Girl, they can't hear me, child. Not if you got your headphones on. Yeah, you know, I don't know how it happens. I have to look that up. Can you look up how a woman gets wizard sleeves? This nigga gonna say wizardry. You so fucking ignorant. I'll have an answer for y'all later on today. I can't stand black men, yo. He gonna say wizardry. I'm dead. Just fuck it. I'm dead. I just can't. Could you imagine waking up Anna? Wait a minute, who is Anna? Oh, wait. I don't know who Anna is. Oh, wait a minute, she deleted that one. Okay. I think she was trying to say waking up and I think having some coochie lips looking like that, child. Listen. Right, and your coochie dragging the floor, child. Listen, no God. I cannot imagine. Mm-mm. No, listen, sitting on that peen that was in that man's scrubs, child, that shit just looked like it hurt. Now, I'm all for a little pain with your activities. You know what I'm saying? I like a little yanky-yanky and a little spanky-spanky. You know, a little fucking and punching. But, listen, let me explain something. That shit would feel like a surgical procedure, and I'm not with that. I don't like my orgasms with surgery, thank you. No, I like my surgery with anesthesia, my nigga. Oh God, don't do that. Mm-mm. That would be like being impaled. It just, mm-mm. No. You know, you can spank me all night and use the crop and the whip and the chains and all that, but you cannot be fucking tearing my shit up. Oh God. You cannot do that. I don't mind you, you know, rearranging the furniture a little bit. You know what I'm saying? But damn, you just fucking, that's like a gut and rehab you trying to do in there. And that I didn't sign up for. No, God, I feel like you're going to pull some shit out with you. I would like to keep the plumbing, sir. Like, don't pull anything out with you. If you didn't go in with it, don't come out with it. The fuck? Leave everything the way you found it. Oh my God. All right, let me get this next deal. I should just stop right here, but I'm gonna read this next little chapter and see what's what, and then we'll get out of here. Chapter 8. Yo B, if I don't wake up from this, Messiah, the doctor said it's a simple surgery. This isn't anything major. They're just putting your port in, Blue said. He laid in the hospital bed, hands behind his head, elbows pointing east and west as he bit his lip. His eyes were on the ceiling. I'm just saying, when I die, Make sure she knows that you loved her. I will, Blue whispered. Messiah was so insistent, always double and triple checking, that Blue knew to tell Morgan Atkins that his love was real. She wouldn't forget. She would carry out all his last wishes. Anything he asked, she would do, because if the shoe was on the other foot, she knew he would do the same. The doctor walked into the room and pumped hand sanitizer into her hands, rubbing them as she smiled. You ready, Messiah? You and I have a date. It's a fucked up date, Doc, Messiah shot back. The woman smiled, shaking her head, and then turned to Blue. I'll send an intern out to keep you updated along the way. It won't take long. Blue nodded. The nurses broke down Messiah's bed, lifting the rails and unlocking the brakes as the bed began to move. Yo, B, Messiah called. He held out one tattooed arm, and the nurses stopped as Blue went to him, grabbing his extended hand. If I don't wake up, Messiah, stop talking like that, she complained with tears in her eyes. I'm gonna tell her. If you weren't so damn stubborn, she would be here. Tell yourself too, B. You're my best friend. A nigga love you too. She laughed through her tears as he lifted one hand to her cheek, swiping the tears away with his thumb. I'll see you when you wake up, she said. Blue stood in the empty room as they wheeled him out. Her heart broke because although he would wake up this time, she didn't know how many more times Messiah would be blessed to open his eyes. And it tore her apart that his time was coming to an end. And that's the end of that chapter. I don't understand why she won't just call Morgan now and tell her that he's sick of the motherfucker. Like, I don't know. Yes, indeed. I knew exactly what you meant. Oh, Lord, child, listen. Okay, hold on 1 second, y'all. Y'all have no idea. Oh, my word. Oh, Jesus Christ on the cross. Listen, you know, you ever have a conversation with somebody in another room, and because you can't see their face, when the conversation is over, you say, okay, bye, like you was on the phone with somebody. I was just talking to myself, and I was trying to think about hurrying up, getting back to y'all. I was thinking about hurrying up, getting back to y'all, that after I said everything I had to say, I said, okay, bye, like we was on the phone talking. Oh, my God, I'm slipping, child. Listen, what the hell? And he had to laugh a little bit, like, okay, bye. Like, where the fuck's she going? I thought she was on live stream. Oh, my God. Who'd she laugh? Listen, Linda. Oh, my God, what the fuck is in my coffee, okay? Jesus Christ on the cross. All right. Now that we got that out the way. Okay, I can give y'all another chapter. Let me see here. I really, y'all felt so bad leaving y'all yesterday. Chapter 9. Alani pulled down the visor above the driver's seat and flipped open the mirror as she applied a coat of gloss over her nude painted lips. Do I look like an author? Alani asked as she turned to Easy, who sat in the passenger seat, eyes glued to his handheld game, thumbs moving a mile a minute. No, you look like a teacher, Easy said without looking at her. Alani frowned and flipped the visor back down, inspecting herself. Did that mean she looked blah, boring, old? Suddenly, she agreed with Ethic. Easy definitely needed an ass-whooping. A teacher, she explained. She reached over and closed his game. Hey, he protested. I need you in the real world when you roll with me, big man, Alani said with a chuckle. Now, tell me, how does one look like a teacher? He shrugged. You just look like you're always going to say something smart, like learning. Learning, huh? Alani laughed. I guess I could look like worse things. Plus, you like my dad, and all teachers like my daddy. There was this one, Miss Greenwood. She used to always send letters home to daddy and smile really big when my daddy came to pick me up. She even baked him a whole pan of lasagna one time, and daddy sent flowers to her as a thank you. Alani's neck snaked backward and her eyebrows lifted. Miss Greenwood, huh? Yep, you look teachery, like her, Easy confirmed. Teachers are simple pretty, not pretty pretty like Dolce. You don't have to paint your face. Paint my face? Yeah, Dolce's face always had paint on it, and it never matched her neck. It was just always a lot of gold paint on her face. You don't do any of that, and you're still pretty. Teacher pretty, like Miss Greenwood. How about I take you to school tomorrow, Alani proposed as she got out of the car. Easy followed along, oblivious to the ways he had ruffled her feathers. Really? Easy asked, his short legs moving double time to catch up with her long strides. You would like that? Alani asked, laughing, amused at his enthusiasm. Yeah, that would be great. All the other kids get dropped off. Their moms walk them in and kiss them goodbye in the mornings. It's always just me. They get good luck from their moms and I don't. So I always get clipped down because I don't start off with the mama magic like the other kids. Alani held open the building's door and motioned for Easy to go inside first. Well, I guess we'll have to make sure you get a little bit of mama magic in the mornings so you can have better days, Alani said. I'll take you every day. Really? Easy's excitement over something so small made Alani's heart explode. This little boy had never had a mother's affection, and it was obvious that he craved it. Really, I won't miss one day for the rest of the year, she said. What if you get sick? Easy asked. Mamas have this thing we do when we're sick. Even when we feel the worst, we pull out our last bit of strength from our secret hiding place to make sure we are there for the people we love. And that's me? I'm a person you love? Easy asked. I mean, I know you love my daddy and Bella because you're always with her, but me too? Alani stepped into the elevator and Easy followed her. She bent down so that she was eye level with him, especially you. The smile he rewarded her that answer with was what? The smile he rewarded her that answer with? I think she meant the smile he rewarded that answer with warmed her, and she pressed the button for the second floor. She made a mental note to spend more time with Easy and then stepped out of the elevator, headed to her professor's office. She entered the space, knocking, but peeking her head into the open door. Alani, please come in. Have a seat, the man said. He was tall and dark, with a bald head and goatee. His kind eyes thinned as he smiled, then bit his bottom lip. It's been too long. Who do we have here? He asked, nodding to Easy. This is Easy. Easy, this is Professor Gates, Alani introduced. Only I'm no longer your teacher. This is a friendly visit. We're friends, he said. Call me Alex. Alani sat and pulled out Easy's chair for him to relax beside her. Okay, Alex, so my book? She frowned and put her hands over her mouth before biting on her thumbnail. Did your editor friend hate it? My editor friend loved it. She said she hasn't read something this gripping since she discovered Ashley Antoinette, the teacher said. No shit? Alani asked, a chuckle of disbelief leaving her lips. No shit, Alex repeated, finding her amusing. His eyes sparkled with interest as he sat on the edge of the desk and leaned forward. He placed a hand on her knee. Her eyes followed that hand to her skin, and Alani looked up at him, slightly uncomfortable. She knew when a man was flirting with her. Didn't she? She crossed her legs, a movement to get him to remove his hand without having to ask. He was smooth, sharply dressed in an expensive suit. Distinguished. She could only imagine the number of undergrads who fell for him at first sight. Alani had eyes for one man, however. They want to get a deal on the table right away. They want to print and unedited copies for reviews, for them to, no, get them out to New York Times, Ebony Magazine, Essence. I can represent you in the deal if you like. I've negotiated a few publishing deals in my day. Wow, really? She asked. Really, Alex confirmed. The entire book was gripping Alani. Lenika, she corrected. She could tell he was getting used to calling her by her first name, and she didn't like it. Excuse me, he asked. Please, call me Lenika. No one really calls me Alani, she said, giving him a muted smile. Lenika it is, he complied. Well, Lenika, we must celebrate. Our new agent-author relationship must be toasted over a glass of wine and an expensive meal. Alani's mouth fell open, but she couldn't find a reply. His body language told her this was not a professional invite. She'll celebrate with my dad, Easy said. Alani rolled eyes of shock to her side, and the look on Easy's face was one of pure possessiveness. He looked her professor in the eyes, unsmiling and unflinching, not at all intimidated like most children would be. He was staking a claim. Alani had a man to take her to celebrate things like this, and it was his father. I guess I have plans, she said with a smile as she reached over and rubbed the back of Easy's head. This little boy here, protective like a son, jealous like a young man, no nonsense like his father. Yeah, I guess so, Alex said, standing. He held out his hand and extended it to Easy. Easy looked at it, letting it linger in midair for an awkward beat before shaking it. Thank you for everything, Alani said. I'll be in touch about the contract, and I'm sure right after you sign, a reading will follow to generate press, Alex said. I don't like that motherfucker. She nodded and then grabbed Easy's hand as they left. Her life was changing rapidly. She had found her footing. She had found purpose after losing it all and feeling like she would never be able to breathe again. Here she was, full on living, succeeding, climbing out of that darkness with a man by her side, a book getting ready to hit the shelves, and an entire city block with her name on the deeds. Who was this woman? How the hell did this woman survive all she had endured? She was walking hand in hand with the most beautiful little boy with a smile on her face as the sun shone down over her. How had this happened? It had just been so dark, so lonely, and now she was living. God, how? That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, not yay. Child, yes, these kids ain't no joke. You heard me? All right. Yeah, y'all, I'm trying to pace this just right because I want to come back at a certain time, like about 4 o'clock. Yeah, so I'm gonna stop right here. Okay, how about that? There we go. So that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 chapters for y'all. Ciao. All right, so I'll come back. All right, so 2 hours from now is what? No, let's make it, what if I come back at like, I gotta get that jive out of the brine too. All right, I'll come back at 4:30. That way y'all can have me on the ride home. Yeah, y'all can have me on y'all ride home from work. Mm-hmm. So then, and then we'll do a couple of hours. How about that? All right, so I'm gonna make the you dig right now. With the you dig being the thumbnail. I'll make that right now, right? And then as soon as and I'll put it out there, and then that way y'all can, because y'all know it only pops up for y'all like 30 minutes after or 30 minutes before the live stream starts. Because I think, let me see what happens if I, let me see. Can y'all still hear me? Okay, y'all. Child, this stream y'all shit is dangerous. And I have to remember to always press the final end button after my music play, because child, one time the music was just playing when it was time for the thing to end. And child, I'm just talking. The music done ended. I'm still talking, but I'm talking to my son in the background. And hold on, one, get out of there. Two, three, might have put five up there. Five. All right. And child, I hadn't even realized that the damn you dig was still playing. Okay, can y'all still hear me? All right, so I had to it won't let me put it out there while I'm still on, but at least it's already made and it's downloaded. So now that it's downloaded, so let me delete those two. I got it downloaded. Yep, there it is. So it won't let me I was about to say stick it in. It won't let me stick it in. I would have to leave out of StreamYard in order to put it up. So as soon as I end the live stream, I'll throw it up in the thing, and then y'all will be able to do it. Okay. So now we're ready. Okay. So listen, thank y'all for listening to me read out loud, okay? I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse. Remember to look both ways before you cross the street, because what? There are loose drivers at the wheel, and I love y'all. And I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one piece. Thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator and for all your hard work, darling. I truly, truly appreciate you, little sis. Y'all make sure you like the video on your way out if you haven't already. And if you do nothing else, 2 minutes after this live stream ends, go to my YouTube page and click notify me, because the new thumbnail will be up there. I'm about to do it as soon as I click the end. I'm not even gonna let the music play long, okay? All right. So after you click notify me, remember to salute your spirit and protect your peace. And I'll be back at 4:30. All right. Bye, y'all.